Library District Board of Trustees to order. It is 7:00 PM on Wednesday, December 16, 2015. Diane, please take the roll.
Carolyn?
Here.
Jeanette?
Here.
Barbara, be previous notice, Patty?
Here.
Linda?
Here.
Tim?
Here.
Okay, please stand and pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay, our agenda tonight in summary is consent agenda, public comment, treasurer's report, director's report, communications, committee reports, liaison reports, secretary's report, new business, unfinished business, executive session, final action, other, and then adjournment. The first item on the agenda is the consent agenda. A is to approve the minutes of the Truth in Taxation public hearing of November 18, 2015. B is to approve the minutes of the regular board meeting of November 18, 2015. C is to approve the minutes of the special board meeting of November 30th, 2015. And D is to approve the payment of the bills for operating expenses of $177,231.29, payroll expenses of $271,015.57, and special reserve expenses of zero, for a total monthly expense of $448,246.86. Does anyone want any items removed from the consent agenda for discussion on the new business?
We're going to discuss this before we take the roll.
Okay, so you want to discuss?
Well, we can still discuss after we second it, move it and second it.
Okay, so do you want a specific one taken off? We can look, we can discuss it later, because right now it's just under consent, so.
Okay, I just had a couple questions, that's all.
You need to send a question.
So moved.
Okay, so moved and out. Second.
I'm not even hearing what's going on, to be honest.
Second, Carolyn?
You got a second.
Carolyn.
Okay. I'm sorry, what's the motion?
It's to entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda.
Oh.
Okay.
All the items above.
So, did we want to entertain to put something off and just try to discuss it later?
No, we're not discussing it now.
Okay.
Well, I had looked it up in Robert's rules, and it says that you can, you know, just be discussing the consent agenda, this, according to Roberts. But
if you have some questions regarding any of the items that are on the consent agenda, it's better to remove it and talk about it separately.
Should we consider maybe removing the consent agenda in the future since it doesn't work for us? Seems to slow us down.
Then we could just take each one individually and then just not have a consent agenda. I mean, it just moves the minutes faster unless everyone already always has discussion.
That's my point. Right. So I'm starting to wonder, but we should maybe just consider
I guess then I'll go back to my original question. Is there anything that anybody would like to remove and we can have some of these particulars as a consent agenda?
Well, I just had a couple questions on the payment of bills. So yeah, then remove B and D.
B and D? Okay, so,
and I had a question about the student taxation document, the ordinance. Is that A?
Yeah. A?
Seems great.
Okay. Yes. So then the only thing we have okay with is C.
C.
Okay, so.
A? Special.
All right, so.
Special reserve.
So then I'll entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the special board meeting on November 30th, 2015. And then do I need a motion a second for that?
I second.
Motion?
A motion.
Okay.
Yeah, you need a motion. Yeah, seriously, I know.
Did I get this one? I have a question. I think I'm going to cause a little more confusion. I'm sorry. This document, this ordinance, is it associated with November 30th or November 18th? So which one do we need to hold or answer a question about this? This was dated November 18th, but I think it was approved November 30th.
Is it that or November 30th? Is that the levy ordinance?
So which one does it associate with? Because then that would be the one we need to hold off on.
Well, associates with.
That was true for taxation.
It associates, I don't know the word associates meaning, but it, in terms of your question, but it relates to items A, maybe B, I don't know what the minutes say about that, C, for sure.
Okay, I have a question about this. I just want to know which letters should we hold? All of them.
Right now, what's before the board is the approval of the minutes from November 30th, 2015. That's the minute before the board at the moment. So those minutes are accurately reflect what's happened at the meeting. There's a motion and there's been a second.
November 30th.
So look at the November 30th minutes and see if there are any questions about the minutes. I guess.
Right. The minutes don't really reflect all that we said at the meeting. They don't even touch base. So called summary. We've been over this time and time again, and I'm still waiting to find out specifically what we think our minutes should include. I thought it was supposed to be a brief summary of the topics. And a lot of the topics aren't even included. So what are we using to gauge minutes? Remember, our attorney gave us a statement.
Actually, I have something here that I just got from board meetings, and this talks about minutes. It says minutes are supposed to be kept and made available to the public. Here, excuse me. Yeah. Sorry.
I'm just
catching
her up. I'm
sorry. Minutes must be kept and made available to the public at a minimum. These must include the names of board members in attendance, all motions made, and the results of any votes.
That's all it says. Good.
It needs to be in minutes.
That's
not
accurate.
So
your minutes need to.
This is according to the library, Journal. That's our academic journal for libraries.
It's just a journal.
It's our academic. That's just like looking at a medical journal. That's your medical. This is our library journal.
Well, if we're going to mirror the village, they don't follow that procedure. Their minutes reflect what takes place in a meeting. I mean, in any entity, you know, your minutes need to reflect your meeting.
I think it needs to reflect a fair summary of the discussion. The discussion was held.
How about the topic at least? I'm not even complaining about how much is discussed.
Of course.
But when I go through the
minutes. Well, what else was happening on November 30th that you felt isn't it? What topic?
And when I went through the minutes, the discussions we had or the questions I brought up weren't even included.
Here's a good example, I think. Just an example, the truth in taxation. All it says is residents of the village who spoke were listed all their names, but no comment or anything on what they said.
Yeah, that is, I thought we all agreed that we weren't going to do that.
And that they were saying.
Well, okay, I thought the board voted in majority that that's how it was going.
And that there's a video, if anybody would like to look through, that there's a video that everyone can look in and brief if they want any other further information.
But I don't think having a video eliminates.
Well, you know, you're right, we have been over this before. And we need the majority of the board members voted to take the minutes as they are taken. And you're right, we've discussed this before, and this is how we decided as a whole.
That your minutes that you publicized don't need to be accurate.
That's not what we decided, Carolyn. You know it.
No,
we decided that a summary would be adequate, particularly because every single word. Is already recorded.
Okay, I'm not
so we
asking.
Don't need a word for word verbatim.
It's not what I'm asking for.
Of the minutes in the minutes that
I'm
are
asking
recorded.
For topics to be included.
Well, what topic is not here that you feel should be here?
Well, that's my point. Am I supposed to come to this meeting with notes and then you all vote me down? So how do we want to handle this? Because I came here before and mentioned things that I brought up and you all voted, forget it, it's not going in the minutes. So I just want to know, what is your expectation? So if we're not going to bring up all the topics, just tell me. I would like somebody
to put it in writing. I asked our attorney, so please give us that statement in writing so I have something to refer to. And then I know where we stand, but every time we talk about it, we talk about something else. So please give me something where I can get explained what you want our minutes to reflect.
Okay, so for what I'm hearing is that you'd like something from writing from the attorney about how the minutes are going to be written. So as of next month, we put that on the agenda.
No, he just needs to make a statement, and she just needs to
write it. Well, you just
said it. You wanted it
writing. No, you wanted writing. So that is what, no, excuse me, let me just finish and we're done.
I don't think we need to pay him. To give us something in writing.
Well, that's what we do.
He stated on the video.
Excuse me, I'm talking.
Go ahead, thank you, please.
What you were just asking is that you want a statement in writing, that is what we will do. If Dennis, if you would please put a statement in writing, we will then put it on our agenda and we will approve it, so there will be no further questions from this day forward.
And what I would like to clarify, that's not what I said. Number one, we pay him more than enough. He already stated on the video, in the minutes, on the recording, 2 months ago, what he felt was an accurate summary of minutes. All I asked that it be placed in the minutes so I can look at those minutes and know what he said. I can't remember from month to month what he said, but whoever transcribed the minutes obviously heard it and could have had it in the minutes and we would all have it. No need for him to spend any time charging us to write up another statement. We have the information.
We understand.
My statement is today what it was 2 months ago, which is, I think it needs to be a fair summary of the discussion that was held at the meeting. That's what my opinion is.
Okay, all I ask is for you to put it in the minutes and then I could read it and see it for myself. It never made the minutes. So then, let me finish.
You can watch the video.
I did, and again, I watched the video. Okay, listen to me, please. I watched the video for the purpose of being able to write it down. And I came back to the meeting and mentioned in that month's meeting, I could not hear him. And I couldn't hear what I was saying. There was something wrong with the recording. And that's why I never found out what he said word for word. And I didn't write it fast enough. That's the only point I'm trying to make here. We don't need to argue and fight every time. I just wanted to know what he said because I couldn't hear on the video and it wasn't in the written minutes.
So now you're saying we don't need it in writing, that you just wanted to hear what Dennis had to say, so Dennis, could you please say it again?
I would like what he says in the minutes so I have it next month.
Okay, so
that's
could
all.
You just make
sure.
A statement?
I think the minutes need to reflect, among things like the date, who's present, a fair summary of the discussion that was held at the meeting.
Dennis, to get a clarification, does that include spelling out what each individual trustee says on a topic?
No.
No. It's a fair summary. But it's
every
topic.
Nor does it have to be verbatim of what everybody says or anybody in the public has to say.
Would it be okay then to just put their name, or would you have to just say?
I'm not so sure that you have to put their name, frankly.
Oh, okay. All right.
I think you can possibly put down there that the public spoke on a certain. But it depends on what the board wants to do in terms of how detailed they want their minutes to be. But I think it needs to be a fair summary. That's, I think, this legal standard. You can determine what that means. And you can determine how detailed you want those to be.
Can we go around then and just say if we would like the names put in the minutes or not? If we could just go around and then we can...
I think in all... I understand what Dennis said. So I guess I'm going to look, not sitting here, I guess I look at if a resident taxpayer went online to pull up the minutes, that they'd be able to tell what, you know, I mean, just, and I'll just use this as an example where, all right, let's just go ahead with the truth in taxation. Residents of the village who spoke were and just gave their name. So they may wonder, well, what were they talking about? So maybe, I'm not saying what Steve said, what David said, what Chris said, but kind of each and every one brought up, you know, don't raise the taxes, or, and if someone else said something different, include that. At least if someone's pulling up the minutes to read, they'll be able to know or understand what happened at the meeting.
So if you don't have a detailed, if you don't have a detailed verbatim statement, the board secretary has to decide what it is that is going to be the blip of the discussion that the person had, right?
It shouldn't be the secretary's decision. It should be the administration that reviews her minutes for clarity and for the level of competency. That's the way it's done.
You said board secretary.
You mean Nakanishi? Well, that's true.
The board secretary is.
She should probably be taking the minutes, because I think that's what it says in the Illinois statutes. Maybe that would take you out of the mix completely.
She can be the recording secretary and do the minutes.
If I can, I think it's a suggestion underneath where all the names are, if we have public comment, if we can just write again, a video recording of this meeting can be viewed on the library's website, would be nice. And that way they can go back to the library, they can use any of the computers here, and then they can review and they can see every single piece of that case.
It's very hard to do.
Well,
maybe
that's something we need to address then. That might be something.
Do we have a plus?
We have 2 minutes. It's very timely, and if we don't need.
Carolyn, I am okay with.
I'd like to go around and just.
I would think that if we could just make a decision and come to a consensus at the board, and then be done with it, and then move on, and not have to talk about it.
Rather than have the video replace this, is what it sounds like she's saying.
No, we're going to do adequate minutes according to what we're all agreeing on. Yes, according to what the attorney said, and then make it as clear as possible to the people that are reading this. But we do have a video now. Otherwise, what's the point of having the video if people aren't going to view it? And maybe we do need to talk about getting a better sound system or something. However, yeah, we'll put on, we'll see how it is from there. But I'd like to just go around and see what the consensus is and then just move forward. So, are we, right now, just, I guess, we're not going with the November 30th, that we're just going to go around and talk about what we want on the minutes? Is that okay?
Yeah,
or no?
There is a motion pending. This is part of the discussion of that motion.
Okay. So, with the motion pending, Danette, should I ask if we want more clarity, if we want more detailed information on the minutes?
My question is, since I'm the one who put this out there, and should we just pull it back and have it reworded since we have this discussion, or are we just, what are we actually doing? We're not voting on anything right now, right?
No.
We're just discussing. Okay. I just want to clarify what actually we're not voting. Okay, that's what
we're discussing. I think right now the discussion is, how detailed does the board, as a board, the majority of the board want the minutes to be. Right?
Right, correct. So, I guess it looks as though it might be the summary of what people were talking about in the public comment. Yeah, it seems like, yeah, more is the focus. So, how do we want the public comment to look? Tim?
I'm okay with the summary of the minutes. If in the public comment, we listed who spoke. We could have this, talking about this particular one, November 30th. We could just say the following residents spoke in favor of it, the following resident spoke against it, the following resident spoke and wagged their finger at us, maybe, if you want to say that, because they did a lot of that. But I'm okay generally with the summary of the minutes. And I believe we're not missing any topic overall, but if we have a topic that's missing, then we need to state that.
I feel what Tim said is fine. I also feel, again, we ought to state that there is a video. If they want more detail, they should view the video.
Can't hear.
Well, then we should still discuss getting new microphones, because seriously, I agree with you. We should get new microphones if there's a problem with the volume or the audio, excuse me.
I think the minutes are fine just as they are. I like them the way they're done. As far as indicating what individuals said, who got up to speak about public comment. I don't really favor saying they spoke in favor of this or against that, because sometimes people's comments were nuanced, and they were partly in favor and partly against, and then we're going to have arguments as to whether or not that person was really in favor of something or really against it. So I would just like them to say that they engaged in public participation. We can list their names. That's fine.
I listened to the audio and I didn't have a problem hearing it, so I guess I would like to know which one you're talking about, because I can hear myself and I think I'm the furthest away from the audio.
The meeting that he brought up, what was an accurate summary of minutes? You cannot hear him. I don't know if he was looking down, but you couldn't. I'm only stating you couldn't hear him at a specific board meeting. I've watched the rest, and many of them are fine.
Right.
So when I needed to hear what he said, I couldn't.
Okay.
That's all I'm saying.
For me, I'm fine the way that they are currently written. And Karen, you brought up a good point about, you know, which point that they are in. And I think the key here is that we need to look at our microphones, is basically it. I think that seems like that's the underlying problem here. More so than the minutes in itself is the volume and to make sure that everyone's heard. So I think that that should be next thing on our agenda to, or send to our technology to look under for new microphones with the direction of the board. Okay, so.
Do you come in?
I'm sorry, Jeanette. Go ahead. I usually start with you, Jeanette.
I agree, like what Karen said. I mean, and I'll tell you, the regular board meeting, these are specific where it says, you know, Trustee Matthias asked, or a discussion was held by Trustee Durbin, Ms. Lemke. So, if I were a senior citizen at home that couldn't get out and didn't have could listen to the video, if I pulled this, I knew what went on in the meeting. It was pretty explanatory. Now, when public comments come up, yes, you don't have to put, like Steve Yasella, he highly disagreed, and Dave Carabota said absolutely. I think what we should do, yes, list the residents that did speak, and then maybe underneath, you know, just they brought up. You don't have to put who said in favor, who didn't want it, but you could, you know, mention, and I'm just using the taxation one because it's just names here, but anyone, just the topic, spoke about, you know, really didn't want it, and also spoke about can't afford to have their taxes go up. It's not like you know, but at least the residents will know what these residents were talking about. They're not going to know who said what, but just some of the topics that were brought up in public comment.
All right. So,
Jeanette,
you want to take this?
Well, I'm okay with that if we have a public comment was on this topic.
Well, the whole meeting was just on one topic.
I
know. So if the other one, if the other regular board meetings are done the way we all are in favor, that's how they're basically going to be. So really, there's no issue with the minutes. It's just this one, which is only about the one topic. It's going to be all on that topic, and they're going to be either in favor or not. So really, that's kind of inferred. So really, it would kind of be redundant if we added that, because people are going to be in favor or not. So maybe for this one, we really don't need to add it because it's only one topic.
No, not this one. No, I was just saying the same.
Right. So
it was just naming residents.
Yeah. Okay. So back to what motion is on. So I think what is said is right now that the minutes are going on the way that they are.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay. So November 30th is still on, or it's a break, so we need a vote.
So the motion is to approve the minutes of November 30th.
Right. Right.
2015, special board meeting.
It's the only motion up on the consent. Right, it's the only one that's up on the consent.
We didn't have discussion on the regular board, right?
Not yet.
Those were the ones you had full, remember?
Right, so C is the only one, so we will go roll call, thank you.
Okay, Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Danette?
Yeah.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Public comments, are there any public comments tonight?
Yeah, you should really probably take the other ones in order or not, so there should be.
Oh, we don't want to put into new business?
No.
But that is what Robert Hill says, says they're removed from the consent agenda to new business.
Well, all right, you can do it that way.
Okay.
So put these aside still?
Okay.
Most boards just deal with it right after.
Very confusing.
Well, if you want to, it's just, to me, consent agenda is supposed to take 30 seconds, you remember what the meeting.
That's the idea.
Consent agendas are driving me crazy.
Usually when passed, if it came out of the consent agenda, then we'd consider it right after the consent.
Exactly, that's how most boards deal with it.
Yeah.
Okay.
Not what Robert Hill says, just see.
All right, so we're going to go back to then, we'll go back to A.
Which is the 18.
Entertainment motion to include the future taxation.
Okay. Right, okay, so, yep. So a motion to approve the minutes of the truth and taxation of public hearing of November 18, 2015.
So moved.
Karen?
Second.
Patty, any discussion?
I have a question about truth and taxation, after we are, right?
Yes.
All right, ordinance 1607.
We're talking about the minutes.
Oh, okay, no, I have a question about the ordinance.
Well, I think that can be brought up later, but now, right now, we're looking at the minutes.
Right, so, Danette, did you have any questions about the minutes of the truth and taxation public hearing?
No.
Carolyn?
No.
Tim?
No.
Patty?
No.
Karen?
No.
Okay, and neither do that. Okay, so if we could please take a roll?
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Danette?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Okay, so then I will entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the regular board meeting of November 18, 2015, item B.
So moved.
Second?
I second.
Karen, Tim? Any discussion?
I just had, where it came up, community report, the building and grounds committee. I mean, not much was said, but signage was discussed, of putting signage on the building and a placement of monument sign. I just. I mean, what type of sign, what?
Well, that was Barbara's report from that meeting, that's not the minutes of those meetings. The minutes of those meetings have not been approved yet. But that is all she said, really.
I was just curious when you say signage, what do you, I mean, on the building, only to say that.
That was just like the discussion.
Yeah.
It was just kind of a topic of discussion.
That we didn't have any signage, which was wow, yeah.
Yeah, that's something that was brought up by residents.
Yeah, there's no.
That they didn't, when they go by, you can't tell it's a library.
The library, right.
No, I was just going to bring up, you know, there's, I'm sure you'll get special dispensation. There's signage regulations.
Oh, yeah, there are.
That's true. Right, so you'll have.
Yeah, there's Trump connection over there.
Before. Something we're checking with the village.
Yeah, before we.
All right, that'll be sharing with us.
Absolutely.
Before we have to take it down.
Who was it, Dylan, Danette? Carolyn, any questions?
No.
Tim?
No, I'm okay.
I'm okey-dokey.
Okay.
Fine.
The only thing I had seen was that word pistachio.
Yes.
Oh, yes.
Oh, Don, let's.
I was gonna.
I don't know, was somebody eating pistachios and didn't bring them for you?
I circled it.
I said it, it's on the second page, I said it, sir.
I thought somebody would get to that before it got to me.
I was. Oh, it's, I said it, pistachio cake.
You know what, I looked right over it.
And I wanted to make a little sign saying that there were nuts for the pistachio.
I looked right over it.
Pistachio, so I could make sure I spelled it right, and I forgot to.
Oh, take it out, yeah.
Because I was proofing the minutes.
In a word document, yeah.
And I just.
Thank you.
But I took it out of the original minutes.
Okay, thank you.
I'd like to amend my motion to take out the word pistachio then.
Okay.
Oh, wait.
The second was, yeah.
No, but I did remove it.
Oh, wait, you know, it's also, there's just one little typo, it says, by trustee Durbin, my line, it says, she informed that board that she, so it should probably be, she informed the board.
Okay, fine.
It's on page 7, I'm sorry.
Page 7?
Yeah, it's just a, the that should be above. That's it.
Let him in with a spine here.
Okay, and just please take the roll.
Sorry. Okay, that was item eight, right? Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Danette?
Yes.
Barbara? Oh, sorry. Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Okay, so entertain a motion to approve item D of the payment of the bills for operating expenses of $177,231.29, payroll expenses of $271,015.57, and special reserve expenses of zero for a total monthly expense of $448,246.86. Karen, Danette? Any discussion?
I do. I looked in the box, the only one I couldn't find, Charles McCoy, $1,200. Huh?
Concrete for him.
I think it was under M.
I looked under M. Because I looked for Main Township, and then I saw that was M, so I looked, but no, it's not there.
Maybe it was under concrete or something.
Well, that makes a lot of sense.
Who knows?
I don't know.
Unless I missed it, but I did look twice.
That is what it is.
You know, we could have put on a month before, because she had the feeling of it already there, but I didn't give her a full final payment. I slept until she put in the other one, so it could have been.
Okay, is that everything tonight? Okay, Karen, any questions?
I just had two, and I didn't look inside any box, I was just wondering if you could tell me what these purchases may be for. I have a feeling they're some sort of computer software or whatever. One's a CDW for $4,472. And then another one was Genesis Technologies. They do service or is it a toner?
Toner and service on the toners.
Toner?
Toner's very expensive.
Mm-hmm. For $3,000.
Well, I mean, you know, we are, you know, supporting a broad printing operation. Consider that we have five printers for the patrons, and what do we have? There's another five or six for
total for the building is about over 50 printers.
Well, that's printers as well.
Yes.
Oh, okay. So it's not only the large copier scanners, but the desktop printers and stuff.
So is that a monthly fee?
It breaks out. We purchase when we need them. We have a limited supply so that we don't have to rush and try to get something ordered. So every quarter A little less. That's how that breaks out.
All right, and then CDW for $4,472. I know we're talking about computers and all that, so.
Yeah, so that's a MacBook that was purchased for digital services to support Studio A. It includes the warranty service, which is AppleCare. And there's also a license in there for Adobe Creative Suite. I think the license for Adobe Creative Suite is a 2-year license.
I think part of the reason for that was that downloading the recordings from the board meetings was taking like 9 or 10 hours on the old laptop, so.
Okay. Well, good. That's all I had. Thank you.
I do have one more. How come we have 2 landscaping companies?
We don't.
We have Chris's landscaping.
Snow removal.
Okay. I just have to see one's Chris's and then Expert's. So.
Okay.
We'll keep them all on the same page.
Tim, any questions?
No.
Patty?
No.
Karen?
No.
And I don't either. Okay, so Diane, please go.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Danette?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Okay, so public comments?
So we're 5 months into the year. Revenue for the month was a little less than budget expectations by $35,000, and a short year to date by $62,000, or 2.1%. Again, this has to do with the way that we collect or are paid taxes from the county, so we expect that to catch up by the end of the year. Salaries for the month are $8,204 short of budget estimates, of 3.1%. Year to date, $107,000, or 8.1% short of budget estimates. Library materials for the month is $9,277 under budget, or 15.1%. $36,000 over budget for the year, or 11.9%. Due primarily to payment of annual subscription fees for some of the library's database product offerings. Library operating expenses, $2,038 over budget, or 7% for the month, $27,714 under budget for the year, or 18.9%. The reason that we're under is that we have slower than anticipated spending in software and printing lines. General administrative expenses, $8,600 under budget estimates, or 32% for the month, and $34,900, or 26.1% year to date. And once again, this is due to slow spending in legal and consultant line items. Employee fringe benefits, just like salaries, are running under budget, $5,211 for the month. $25,776 for year to date, that's 9.1%. Utilities is within $1,000 of budgeted expense, both monthly and year to date. And the net surplus or deficit for the month, the net deficit is $425,000, which is $107,000 favorable to the budgeted net deficit of $532,000. And $294,000 favorable, or 153% year to date. So if you have any questions on the financials, do you have to address them?
I do. I have one. Wait, one point.
Can you page number?
Okay, I'm on the, I think it's on this one. Okay. Even on the consolidated page 20, I'm just curious why Because you know me, I always look for trustee line. How come that shows year-to-date actual negative 85 and actual percent annual negative 1%?
We got a refund early in the year for something that we had spent in the trustee line item the previous year. I could research that if it's...
No, I was just, I'm like, well, wait, how does it... I mean, it looks like, holy crap, we already spent the 10 grand and now we're in the negative?
No, no, year-to-date actual is a credit of $85.
Well, yes.
So...
It sounds like we didn't pay anything.
Well, we had, you know, for example, if you look for the month, we spent $302 against the budget of $833. So we were $531 under budget. Year-to-date, we have an $85 credit, which means that we have, going into the month, a credit of $387. Okay? So the year-to-date budget is 4167, but the year-to-date variance is 4252, which is the 4167 plus the 85.
Why would we get a refund?
I'd have to research it.
You signed up for maybe you could decide it again. Okay, any other questions for Greg for the treasurer's report?
No? I just have one.
Okay, go ahead, Karen.
On page 32, you mentioned that we expect to catch up the budget expectations throughout the year. Is the shortfall is due to primarily to your real estate tax collection rate? Sorry. Are the collection rates down some this year, or is it just a lag?
They vary. You know, it's, I mean, I try to predict as much as possible based on what's happened in the past, because it, you know, because it's not a smooth year, you know, it's not a smooth 12 months. We're guessing at the way, we're guessing at the way that people are going to pay their taxes. We're guessing at the way the county is going to send them to us. We're guessing whether or not there's going to be refunds in past years, you know, like going back to 2001. And we just happen at this point to be a little bit under about $60,000.
Okay.
So, I mean, it's nothing to be alarmed about.
Okay.
Okay.
Any other questions? Director's report?
Right. Most of my information is in the written report. I did want to mention that after I made your little trustee calendar here, I found in the chamber newsletter that there's one more thing, which is in January 14th, so it's before the next meeting, so I wanted to mention it, is the leadership luncheon that the chamber puts on, where the mayor speaks and you get to hear about the development in the village. So it's a possible event that you might want to go to. People have gone to in the past.
And what was that date, Susan?
January 14th, which I think is a Thursday.
14th.
What time is it, you know? Also lunch.
Yeah.
What day of the week is it?
Thursday.
Would you mind emailing that to all of
sure.
us just to...
Happy to.
Yeah, just to have it in writing.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I was going to ask you in terms of events, what is going on tonight at the library?
Battle of the Books.
Oh, okay, great.
Yeah.
Why did you say
and also, yeah.
To not have board meetings on the same night that you had books. I was driving around the block in the parking lot.
Are you honking?
Maybe.
I
know there were a lot of people, there were people honking out there because it was quite congested. And
it's also finals, and so we
yeah.
lost.
So,
right now.
You know, maybe just, I mean, fortunately, we do not have a number of people trying to attend a board meeting tonight, too, because it would have been even worse had that been the case, but it really was really bad out there in terms of, you know, it, obviously it's a very popular event, and we can avoid scheduling it on the same night with other events. It was really bad out there.
Okay. Good problem.
I know.
Sorry. Let's see. I also just on the calendar wanted to point out that in February there will be a legislative meetup where you get a chance to meet with different state senators and people like that. And then anybody that wants to go to the Public Library Association Conference in Denver in April is going to need to tell Diane very soon, because we want to get your registration in on time. And also the hotel rooms are a little bit tight. So please do let her know. So that's calendar stuff. You had asked about our electrical usage, and so I just want to let you know that Dave and Greg have been working with Commonwealth Edison to do a kind of an energy audit, and they should be getting the results of that soon. They've started getting, they've got some preliminary results, but we'll give you more information on that next month.
No, it'll be about a month before we do that.
And then we also followed up on the credit cards. We have tried a number of places, and unfortunately what we're finding is that you need a social security number to get any of the cards with points. And I'm not willing to put my social security number, I'm sorry. So
I'll ask John to do that, because I'm sure he's not putting his out there.
Well, we went directly to MB Financial and looked on their website, called them up, and they need a social security number. So either the program has changed.
Right, no, I'll ask John what he did. If he could put his up, I'll be very surprised.
You can't use like an employer ID number?
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Like a FIN number?
Yeah.
Well, they want somebody to guarantee it. Most of those cards are small business cards.
Could have changed.
So we checked with American Express, small business, and MB Financial, and they were both adamant about getting social security numbers.
And then we do actually get points on our current card, but it's for things like travel. We can do very well.
I mean, could we use that for sending people to conferences by any chance?
We'll look into that. We'll look into that.
I mean, it's better than nothing.
Yeah, I mean, most of the offerings are vacation type, you know, things, unfortunately.
That's right. And then, I just
not
like then I just wanted to alert you that we do have a big exhibit starting in March on the history of candy in Chicago, about all the old candy companies and stuff will be out here in our gallery area. And we're putting together several programs to go along with that, and we will probably have a kickoff party for it that you all will be invited to. Some people from the village just want to be there. Start getting excited about that. So
maybe these companies that are still around.
And when does that start?
Beginning of March.
Beginning of March.
Dodie is in here, I think, isn't she? Yeah. Dodie is the point person around that. She's
actually, Susan, I was going to bring that up at some point, too. Were you events of that nature where the mayor is invited or the representative is invited, could you give us a heads up a couple of weeks in advance?
Certainly.
The Korean thing. I was vaguely aware that it was going on.
Yeah.
There's so much going on.
That was bigger than we have any idea that it was going to be.
Yeah. And it's out of the hand of the board members were really there for
that. That one I was at only because I kind of got involved in the beginning. I saw him at some other event.
Did you get your picture with it? Because I didn't see any of us.
Oh, no, no. I was in the back. No. But, I thought it was a great idea.
Sunday.
It was a good crowd.
Anyway, just in general, things of
yes,
that nature.
Anything that's big, I can let you know about any programs. I think that's actually a good idea. Now that I think about it, that you could be kind of letting people know
things
about
things.
Well,
things where they're, other people are getting their pictures, because we want us to be in those pictures.
Absolutely.
Oh,
it'd be, you
know, advocating
for the library. Not so much a picture, but advocating for the library.
Yes. All right, does anybody have any questions for me?
No, I just wanted to specify that I really like the beginning too of just clarifying some of the points that some of the residents were unsure of, and just to clarify some of them. It was good even for me to, you know, read through. I mean, even though a lot of them are new, but I thought that was really great. And it was really nice it's too bad that I really wish I was at that holiday event to see Neil light the tree.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good.
Nobody was there.
I know. Yeah, and I drove by it, and I was like,
the three of us, no one else, the library was there, bringing stories.
I know.
Yeah.
Yep, so anyway, yeah, they said they gave away all 200 of the crabs.
Three trustees for that.
We needed that, it wasn't being a little louder because of that thing.
Okay, all right, communications, there are no communication reports, committee reports. Let's see. Buildings and grounds, we did not have a meeting, liaison reports, friends of the library, Carolyn?
We didn't have a meeting, but we had a luncheon on Saturday the 12th. And the library volunteers were invited to attend. And there were actually three volunteers from the library that did attend. They were Harry Weber, Arlene Turek, and Chris Flynn. And if I remember the details correctly, these people have volunteered for many, many years. And it was a great luncheon, it was just a lot, like the table was this big, I was shocked. So it was a nice crowd, and that's all I have.
Carolyn, can you tell us when the next meeting is?
Oh, it's on the.
I used to be at.
It's the second.
It's on the blue.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I think, is it the second Monday or the first Monday?
It's the second Monday of every month.
Thank you.
However, the January one is postponed.
But that one's canceled?
Yes, January's canceled.
What about the February, you think that was going?
February 8th, he said that it was.
Okay, so February 8th is the next one?
Yes.
Actually, Susan, this is like the smallest thing in the world, but you don't have to put that in the blue like that. For me, it makes it difficult.
Okay, I was just gonna say the same.
Yes.
It's a smaller previous form.
Yeah, just regular.
And can you just make one suggestion about that? Can we get like the whole year, 6 months at a time? Is that too hard to do?
No, you can do it, but I can do whatever you want.
Is that like a plan in advance?
Okay.
Do, can we do a Google calendar where you can just send it to us and where we're invited? You know how? Do that at school, where it just kind of goes out and it just kind of.
Well, you know what, it just pops up, like with me at work at the school, when an event is coming up, it just pops up on my regular email.
Right.
So if I'm looking at my regular email, a couple of days in advance, even it'll pop up, so I know.
Doesn't work that way. Well, my experience of trying to get people to work on a Google calendar is that it's really hard to get everybody's.
Doesn't Outlook have a calendar?
Yeah, your Outlook calendars could have these dates on them.
So you send an invite and it'll pop in there.
Okay, that would be great.
If that I can.
Okay, that'd be perfect, yeah, because we is out, yeah.
But can we have.
Of course, we have, yes, but that's okay.
So are those like alerts, or is that the only way you'll send?
She could create an alert,
It could be, it would probably be like that invitation to something, a meeting.
I would have, we can get a calendar in advance and paper, because I'd like to just fill it in. Is that a problem? Like, whatever you give us now, can we just have it a little bit elaborated, yes.
Okay.
Like, I think Linda used to give us almost a year.
No, Linda actually only gave you a couple months, I actually expanded. But I'd be happy to do that.
I have some old ones, but I'm saying, just so that we could plan them and get our personal lives in there too.
Sure.
But if you, I know I don't have, I don't pay attention to emails during the day, I can't keep running back on my library email. So I would miss them, my only concern.
Yeah.
But I mean, if you wanna do both, but I'd like something in paper.
I know you have like a few, maybe, five or six months, I think that would be funny.
Okay.
You know, just a few in advance. 6 months, that'd be great, if you have the dates.
Yeah.
And then we can just, and then it's updated.
It's added to you all the time, but.
Right, it's something. Okay, great, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, communications, committee report, legislative?
I would like to combine legislative and rails, because they are very connected right now. I did have a rails meeting last week. We got a report from the state library. The General Assembly gave them $10.1 million that had been, waiting, they had not been getting any of their funding for the year. So they finally got $10.1 million, which got everybody all excited, because everybody thought, oh boy, per capita grants, and it apparently virtually all of that money is going just basically to keep the lights on. For strictly operations. They did mention that there's a $4 billion backlog of bills at the comptroller's office.
Because they haven't approved their budget yet.
Yes.
Right?
Yes. Yeah. So over 6 months, yes.
Yeah.
I know.
They are stuck. Rails, though, says that they have a healthy reserve, so they are not worrying yet. The main thing, Rails has a number of functions, but the main thing that they do is facilitate the delivery between the libraries of all the materials going back and forth. So they feel that they can keep that going for some time, but you know, that is not the case with the, that's the north half of the state. The south half of the state is not in that same shape, so it's a serious situation.
The state pays for that? Does the library pay into that to reimburse? How does that work?
State pays the two systems, and the systems facilitate the delivery. Yeah,
so it's outside of our budget?
It is outside of our budget, but that I could see a time where if they don't get their money, that yes, that actually came up a few years ago where it started to look like we were going to have to start taking on some of the delivery fees ourselves. So that is both legislative and Rails. They did want people, though, to encourage people to write to your local representatives and senators just to say thank you for the money that they did give, because at least it's a start.
For secretary's report, since Barbara isn't here, Karen, would you please read the secretary's report?
You just want me to read it?
Just read it, yes.
Okay, a certified copy of Ordinance 15-07 and Ordinance Levying Excessive Taxes in the Niles Public Library District, Cook County, Illinois, for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2015 and ending June 30th, 2016. Together with a certification by the President of the Board, certifying compliance with the truth in taxation law, was filed with the Cook County Clerk's Office on December 8, 2015. The ordinance was posted for public inspection. That's it.
All right, the next item is new business. I'll entertain a motion to approve item A, which is to recommend changes to policy 3.05 in lending regulations. A motion?
So moved.
Karen?
Second.
Jeanette? Susan, can you tell us about this change, please?
Yes. 3.05 looks like this. It's a grid that we keep up all the time. We try to keep most things consistent, but every once in a while we'll pull something out and treat it a little bit differently. Magazines, we think we would get much more circulation out of them if we shortened the circulation period to 1 week, because obviously it doesn't take a long time to read a magazine. And we also want to start, I've always held on to the current issue, page 46. I'm sorry, I should have said. We have normally have not let the current issue go out, and we feel like we don't see a huge amount of in-library use, so we would like them just to all be available to go out. We think that will, you know, get much more useful. So that's the change that we are suggesting.
I guess that my question was, or I think you've already answered it. I always thought the reason why you didn't let it go out was so that everyone had a chance to look at the magazine during the month after it came out. And that's why it didn't circulate.
That has always been the theory. And then I think in the past there was more of that. But people are reading things on tablets and things like that these days as well.
Do people actually check out magazines?
They do some. The number in the statistics looks like it's gone down drastically, because last year we had the Flipster in with those numbers, and this year Flipster has been pulled out into digital. But yeah, they do still check out the magazines some.
And in our databases, a lot of the magazines, we have them in there too. So we can look at the same, and it's almost real time. It's pretty much the current magazine is in the databases.
I thought you canceled the hotspots.
Oh, good point. Well, I guess we're still hoping that we'll be able to do it. So I guess we could just hold it there and hope that there will be something to fill that slot. But yes, at the moment there are no circulating hotspots.
Any other discussion? Okay. Can you draw? Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. I will entertain a motion to approve a recommendation expenditure of $6,450 with Malon Manufacturing Company for cabinet work.
So moved.
Karen?
Second.
Karen Jeanette? Susan, can you tell us what this work is for?
I have to refer that to the right.
So we have been up to five projects that we've asked Malahan to bid on. One is, the first one is that we have some cabinet doors that need to be replaced down in the lower level. The second is a cabinet for the lower level to house some of the equipment that we're getting from that we're getting for the digital services department. Third project is a cabinet in the children's area to better organize and provide additional storage for some of their materials.
It's replacing a set of plastic shelves that are behind the desk of the games.
The fourth is to replace the temporary barriers around the front entrance. If you notice, you know, there's something that looks very temporary. Those large vertical signs, which aren't really securing anything, we want to do something a little bit more permanent, a little bit more sturdy. And then lastly, a 30x60 table for the children's area to replace a folding table that we have our catalog in, as well as one other piece of equipment that I can't remember off the top of my head. But the total is $6,450. There are three bids here. Mylan, TJ Installations, and Garvey's. And the one that we're recommending is the lowest.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Go ahead.
You know, I was just wondering, these first two businesses, are these really separate firm businesses? One's at 5900 West 65th Street, and one's at 5900 and a half West 65th Street.
Yeah.
So I was just wondering, are these really...
Well, there are two separates. It's a, he leases space to another gentleman, but he's cabinet very well.
Oh,
so,
how legal does that look?
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
It is what it is.
You know, I had a question if you were finished explaining. I looked at all three of them, and I'm assuming, are they all bidding on the exact same product? Because it doesn't say, like, the name of the cabinetry. Like, is it a...
These are constructed.
Okay, so, and it's all the same material. They're just charging you a different price. So you're getting the same thing. I just couldn't figure out if Garvey's was giving you one manufacturer and somebody else was giving you something else. So even Garvey's is already, they're already put together, right? That's why they're so expensive.
Everything is, they're all, it's all cabinetry that's made from the specs.
Okay.
So it's all Formica, pressboard.
Okay, so it's all the same thing.
It's all the same thing, it's just that they're made from scratch.
Because it doesn't give you any details, and it was hard for me to understand. But
we have the, I can get the drawings.
Oh, no, not at all. I just thought, are we all talking about the same thing, three different companies? Okay, great. You know, it makes sense. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I was just wondering when we solicit bids, how do we choose who to solicit bids?
I look in the blue book.
Okay.
And then I go through the blue book and I find the one that's paying prevailing wage, and that's how we look at.
Oh, okay.
We go for bids.
All right. I would just hope, and you probably do, that we try to get bids from Niles businesses.
I do. That's the first place. That's why I went to Garvey. It was the first place I went to.
Okay.
And I try to keep everything local if I can. But there's sometimes it's not possible.
Okay.
Well, the price difference is...
Any other questions? Take a roll, please. Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Okay, I will entertain a motion to approve item C, expenditure of special reserve funds in the amount of $32,431.99, enough to exceed for the purchase of 20 patron computer laptop workstations and one laptop cart from Dell Computers for the digital services Studio B and meeting room spaces. Motion?
So moved.
Karen?
Mm-hmm. Second.
Patty? Can you tell us about this, Susan?
Sure. These are to replace desktop units that are currently in what used to be called the training lab and is now, it's called Studio B. They are 7 years old, and at this point, they can't really run training for people on some of the most modern software because it can't be installed on the old desktops. It also will, because they're going to be laptops instead, they'll be much more flexible. It's also to replace this laptop and the other laptops in some of the meeting rooms, which are the same age. And there was one more thing, reason that we wanted to do that. Do you remember, Greg?
So we have 12 laptops or desktops in Studio B. This will increase our capacity so that we can have classes with an 18 max in Studio B. Also, it'll allow us to use the units elsewhere in the building. It won't be as, for example, if they wanted to have a class in this room, they can do that because the laptops are very portable. They'll be in a cart with wheels, as opposed to trying to get half a dozen or a dozen desktop computers from downstairs out there. So it'll make that type of it'll enable us to use them more. Also, they'll be open to other departments. So, if KidSpace, for example, has a program, you know, they could request their computers from that cart as well. I do want to point out that we have a 44% discount off of the standard Dell computer pricing schedules. I want to direct your attention to the last sentence of the penultimate paragraph on page 51, where there's a typo. It says 24%. It should be 44%.
That's great.
So while we were just sitting here, it got better. The per unit cost is $1,544.20 each. That price compares favorably to the desktop purchase price in 2008, which is still sitting downstairs, of $1,442. And in 2008, we paid $1,975 for each laptop. So, these are business units, and they're outfitted so that they're more durable. We have in this insurance for years 4 and 5, so we're paying a 5-year replacement for the insurance is important because the nature of laptops is that they could be dropped.
Mm-hmm.
You know, somebody could pick them up and drop them. We'd sure like to have the opportunity to replace them at no cost if we can. That insurance and as well as warranty coverage is embedded in the price for the first 3 years. So, the extra is for just years 4 and 5. This also includes a cart. The cart is $1,547.99. So almost just about the cost of a single laptop. And the cart has enough spaces for the 20 laptops. The cart will be outfitted with a switch so that they'll be on the network, so they could be updated, patched up, without having to physically remove them and turn them on and do that stuff. We can do it while they're sitting in the cart. The cart will also charge them, but not cook them. So we don't. It'll charge the computers, but it won't cook the batteries. So we don't run the risk. We don't run the risk of burning the batteries out.
Is that cart only 20 spaces?
Is it
only 20? Okay.
Is it 20?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Did
yeah, yeah.
Did
yeah,
you
just
see
like
the,
that?
Yeah.
So, I want to point out that all of our computers are, you know, between 7 and 8 years old. We have approximately 180 or 190 units in total in the building, between patron computers and staff computers. Those, our goal this year is to replace them all. But, you know, we can't buy 180 or 190 units at one time because, first of all, we just don't have a place to put them. And second of all, but, you know, it'll be quite a while before we actually got down to the last unit. So we're going to stage the purchases over the next several months with the goal of being completely upgraded by the end of the fiscal year.
I had one question. I know in order for the library to function, Windows 10 is not favorable. So,
at the moment, right.
So I realize you're going to be buying new units and then you're going to have them. You're going to have that removed and have, what is it? Are you running
Windows 7? 7.
Okay. Who's going to be doing that? Is it going to be in house? I know we have it out. And then have you figured out how long? I mean, almost 200 computers. That's quite a bit of work, do you think?
7 months.
I mean, I was just curious if we could get some sort of plan in place, like when you'd be buying what. I was thinking of it when I was home and going, oh my gosh,
we'll have an outline.
That's a lot of work.
We'll have an outline for the board in January.
And then it'll be when you want to purchase and so forth and so on, so we can just have the whole year at a glance. Okay, great.
Yeah.
Ideally, some of the vendors that don't have, that we use their products that don't run on Windows 10 by then, maybe will be, by the time we're buying some of these, maybe we'll get there.
Yeah.
That's
the goal.
That's
the goal.
Tonight, you have any questions?
The computers you're replacing on this, what are we doing with the old ones?
Well, you know, generally speaking, companies refresh their computers every 3 years. We're at 7 or 8 years at this point, somewhere in that range. So the, you know, certainly the book value is zero, the economic value is zero.
Right.
In most cases, we'll be harvesting the screens and the keyboards and the mouses or the mice. So it'll just be the box. In all likelihood, we're not going to find a buyer for them.
No, I'm not saying. I mean, is there a way you could, like, donate some, say, the Niles Teen Center?
These are Windows XP boxes.
Yeah, these are real.
Yeah.
Normally, that is what we would do, but they've gotten so
old
this time.
I was shocked. These are really outdated.
Or like kids that would love to have a computer, but they can't. They probably love it.
But there's no internet, there's no also,
there's no peripherals,
there's no keyboard or monitor or anything.
Well, I meant they could if we give the whole thing. I know that.
Yeah.
Don't need the whole thing to a kid that would love a computer. He doesn't care if it's 20 or 10.
We'll definitely donate them anywhere that we can, but we're not aware at the moment of a great possibility. I know there's a place we have donated to in the past, in a certain trauma.
Yeah, but I can imagine.
Now
I
know
we don't want to pay someone to take them.
No.
I noticed in the Village of Niles recycling booklet. Yeah, the booklet that just came out, there was a recycling place for electronics too.
There
so.
You go.
That sounds good.
I just wanted to mention too, just when I was looking at the Dell computers, I just wanted to kind of see, so I just Googled it. And I wasn't sure about, like, was it Core, and then it said i5 or i7, and then I noticed on here that we're getting the i7, which that just means that there's more memory, maybe? i7?
It's the faster processors.
Faster processor.
Of the business or consumer.
Yeah, so it seemed like we were getting the better computer, but the amount that came up just right off the bat on the website was $1,669, so that was already way higher than what we were getting, and it seemed like we were getting more support 5 years where they didn't have all that included. So it seemed like a pretty good deal. Yeah, it seemed like a pretty good deal compared.
Solid state hard drive, which is more expensive.
I mean, I know we're getting a quantity, which, you know, gives a little break, but some, you know. But, so I mean, that was good to see, just right off the top, it was already, you know, a couple hundred dollars more, and then it said, and then press this for add-ons, so.
Does the insurance cover a droppage?
Yeah.
No camera software, does that mean that it doesn't have that little capacity?
It does have a camera, but the camera software is not necessary with the operating systems. So it's an added expense, so we try to keep it to the minimum of what is actually needed, without having to pay for extra, those options that you alluded to.
Okay, anybody else have any questions for Debbie? Tim?
No, great.
If we can take a roll? Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Deanna?
Yep.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, I'd like to make a motion to approve the Niles Public Library District 2015-16 salary schedule. Go ahead, motion. Good, Karen?
Yes. Second.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
And Susan, can you tell us about any changes, please?
Yes, it basically changed, some of our titles had changed since the last time we updated this, which was all the way back in 2012. Well, for example, circulate, it still said circulation clerks and things like that, so we changed some of the titles that have changed, and then Greg looked at the CPIU, Consumer Price Index for Urban Areas, and went back for that amount of time to see how much, what percentage to raise it by, and so it raises both the minimum and the maximum by that percentage, which is 3.45. And the reason for that is partly just to keep our salaries a little bit competitive, but also because some people had been working here long enough that they were bumping outside of the range completely. So, but this is basically just an updated version of our salary schedule. We, at some point this year, do want to really look at our salary ranges and do a more comparative study and see, you know, what the going rate is for these things and do a little bit more analysis on it. This is really just to get it up to date.
So what this is, an increase of 3.45%.
It's just on the ceiling of it and on the bottom of it.
But we just raised salaries 3%, so we are now raising them.
We raised the current staff 3%, but
These are the these are salary ranges. So if you have let's say a certain type of employee, and let's say the employee's range is $10,000 to $20,000.
Mm-hmm.
Those numbers, that range, was established in 2012. Okay, so what we've done is we looked at CPI, which has increased 3.45%. And I got all the data on page 61. So
no, I'm sure
it.
You have, yeah, no, I believe it.
So now it's, you know, now it'll be slightly higher. I'm not going to do that. But let's say it's $10,300 to $20,600. So we're not raising anybody, but we're sliding the range a little bit. Because over time, in the previous 3 years, the people in that range have gotten raises. And if you keep the range exactly the same in 2012 dollars, eventually they're going to bump outside of that range, but holding the same position.
I see.
Okay. So we're just sliding the range by inflation, and you know, it keeps.
And the purpose of this is to keep us competitive, because CPI really isn't one companies use to give you more increase, but this is so our salaries are more in line with other ones, so we're competitive, correct?
Yeah, and I think the matrix report showed that we were a little bit low in terms of,
yeah, I read that.
In terms of midpoints in our mm-hmm. ranges. So this is part, you know, partly to catch that up. I think when we looked at the Lacombe survey a couple of years ago, we showed that actual payments to our employees, not the ranges, but the payments, tended to have a lot of our employees, you know, right at the midpoint or a little bit under. You know, so, I think it's obviously, we think it's the right thing to do.
But it's not gonna change anybody's salary.
Correct.
It's just gonna leave.
No, I am, I feel what you're saying. No, now I do, because I'm sitting at home going, 3.45. And that, yeah, but it makes sense.
Any other questions, Karen? Tim? Katie?
No.
Karen?
No.
For the vote, please. Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Jeanette?
Yes.
Kelly?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Yes.
Now we'll move to item E, under new business, discussion on the per capita application FY16 requirements. This will be a short review of our progress in meeting the technology goals set in this year's requirements for filing the per capita grant application due in January. The board is also required to discuss resource sharing and educational programs and training opportunities.
So each year, we fill out a per capita grant application. This year, they are running late. They told us not even, they're sending it in until January. Normally, it's due in October. So normally, you would have heard this back last summer. And so for fiscal year 2016, the requirements of the grant were that we had to file our annual report with the state, which I did this summer. We had to, one of the things we have to go over tonight is, there's a book called Serving Our Public 3.0, Standards for Illinois Public Libraries. And the instructions this year were to go through the chapter on technology and see how we're doing with that. And I think we do all got a copy of that. And probably reading through this, you can see for yourself that we have, some of it is very basic, that we have, you know, a photocopier, a telephone, that we have voicemail, that we have some kind of very basic things, that we have an internet browser that people can use. So some of these were, you know, not a stretch for us in any way. There, and so as I go along, I can see that, you know, we meet each one of the qualifications for this. And some of them are more general. It's things like library staff must be computer literate, trained to use and assist patrons in the use of electronic resources and materials. So, you know, these are all things that we have been doing for a number of years and that we have recently improved a good deal on with the introduction of digital services and the restructuring of the library. The one that we are, still need to be working on in the coming year is point number 13. The library develops and updates at regular intervals a long-range strategic plan for its future technology needs based on community needs and priorities. This will be something that comes up in the course of doing our strategic planning in the next few months. And then also, as we talked with Carolyn and Tim about on Monday night, we will be beginning a technology steering committee in the library that will be working together with Rich and Greg on building a kind of technology plan. So that's something that we still need to work on a little bit, but we have a plan for working on it. The other thing that we still need to work on a little bit is point 17, the library applies for E-rate discounts, and that is a fairly complicated process to apply, and we have not done that for us. Have we ever done it, Rich?
No, we were investigating it, and at the time, it only applied to communications, but you had to be fully SEPA compliant.
Right, and now we have the internet filter, so now we actually can finally apply for it.
Although now they've changed the rules, so.
There we go.
They're removing that first component, and there's a whole new component that is even more complicated. So we've been sitting in on some of the state-provided webinars on how to actually roll that out.
So we're pursuing it, but we're not there yet. But other than that, I think that we are very much on track for this Chapter 5 technology. I will run over briefly with you next month what we're supposed to work on for the coming year, which is Chapter 6 on access.
Coming year, you mean January?
Yes.
So is there somebody at the state that reviews your discussion on this to see whether or not?
You have to put it in the application that you did all these things. I prefer not to lie, so we're.
Okay.
Let's see, we're also supposed to discuss our educational programs and training opportunities for patrons. It says, identify educational programs and training opportunities the library currently provides to its patrons. And I think we all know that we provide a huge amount of training and education programs for our patrons. Just a brief look through Chapter 1 will tell you that. I do want to just point out that we have a few particular strengths in that area. We do a great deal of work with people that are looking for jobs and information about career building and things like that. We do a lot of finance programs. We have a very strong array of business programs. And we have finance programs, you know, we have financing your college career, we have, you know, writing your will, we have getting, you know, challenging your house assessment, we have all kinds of financial type programs. We have a strong array of computer programs, and that will be getting better once we get our new laptops and we can do some of the most cutting edge technology. People these days want, you know, they want what they currently have, not what we had 7 years ago. And then the new Wonderground, which is our little STEM room that you all saw, that has a regular series of educational programs where she goes topic by topic each month. I think this month is light, last month is optics. So I think we have some very strong training and education opportunities here at the library, so I don't feel concerned about that. So it's obviously, you know, a big part of what we do here. And then we were required to complete something called the EDGE assessment. And Karen came in one day last year, I threw it out to the whole board, and Karen was the one who said she was willing. And so it's a computer assessment where you rate yourself on all these different benchmarks for your technology. And so I think we completed that. We came up with a quite good score. There were a couple of areas where we are dipping a little bit low, but they are all things that we either addressed in the last year or will be addressing in the coming year in terms of planning. One thing that we don't yet have is offering any kind of computer training in other languages. So that would be a thing to work for, is maybe having Polish computer classes or something like that. So that was one of the things where we're a little bit light. I'm actually going to redo this now. They opened the door on taking the assessment a second time and comparing. So I will be doing this again very soon.
Materials in other languages, training materials in other languages, comply with offering it?
I think it was worded that it was one-to-one or classes being taught at some place. So it didn't sound like just having
the
materials.
Is that a requirement for the entire Illinois libraries?
It's not a requirement. It's a benchmark. It's what a very good library would be offering. Yeah, I don't think we're ever going to hit every single point on here, because not every single one really would be appropriate for our community. There were a couple where I kind of went, yeah, no, we're not doing that.
Sure.
Because it's not suitable for us. But yeah, I will be redoing that, and I'll bring you those results when it's done and see how we've done in terms of improving. Then the last thing is the trustees, the library board. Last year, your goal was to analyze the library's finances and fiscal climate, which we did in about 5 minutes. This year, you were supposed to identify and describe how library funds are used to support educational programs and training opportunities for patrons. And you're supposed to talk about, with the board and the staff, we're supposed to talk about how the library fosters resource sharing. And so I think clearly you provide funds for programming and education and training through the salary, through the program line of the budget. Exactly. Right, that's another one. Right, so that we have staff that's trained to be able to help people with things.
And not only that, we have staff that go out to the schools.
Yes.
Too, that are liaisons. So, right. I mean, we constantly have Donna calling us and giving us her materials, so we have them up right now.
That's great. So I think that we clearly do very well on that one, and then we also do very well on resource sharing. Resource sharing is talking about where each library is trying to pool their resources a little bit, so that you've got this and they've got that, and so your patrons can be checking things out from the other libraries. And so that's where our participation in CCS, where we're working together with the other 23 libraries. We get the resources for our patrons very fast, and we're fairly even on the amount we borrow and the amount people borrow from us. And then another area in which we do resource sharing is that we have a world languages cataloger, and she works in technical services, and she is cataloging things like our books in Gujarati, say. And she is has such a high level of authority that her records are entered into OCLC, so she's actually changing records for the whole country. So that's another way to be sharing our resources with other people. And then, of course, obviously, we're using their records as well. So we do a lot of resource sharing here. If you had any thoughts on other ways that we could be doing it, I'd be happy to hear. I think a strength of ours. We're generous and we borrow a lot for our patrons and other people borrow a lot from us.
Is there one library that is earmarked for having the best resources? I mean, you look at someone and say, wow, that's not us, or
yeah.
Oh, we pretty much.
It's a little hard being down the street from Skokie sometimes.
Oh, really? Is it paying that much?
They're double the staff, double the budget. So, yes.
Really?
Glenview, too.
Glenview is very nice, but Skokie is fantastic.
A lot of the libraries might focus on certain collections.
Skokie is still.
You know, like Arlington Heights is focused, I know that they used to be like cooking or something, you know, like they have like a section that was, you know, they focused on that thing. There might be a certain.
A draw for them and that's what.
A certain, yeah, library might have a focal point that they really boost off.
Good point.
And then another area for resource sharing is in our world languages, the people working in our world languages, and then they've been networking lately and figuring out how to purchase things better and do things like that, which I think is also excellent. So if you have any guidance for me on what you would like this year's per capita grant application to include, I hope you will let me know. I do have to turn this in before the next board meeting. I was basically planning to do pretty much what I did last year, which was split the money between technology supplies, because that's an ongoing expense, and anything in this, it has to be.
Just going to answer the parameters.
Yeah, well, you know, different places do all kinds of things. I would never want to risk putting something in there that we couldn't do without, mm-hmm. because I'm not sure we're going to get the per capita grant.
So
it all has. We got $71,605 the last 2 years. We will not get that this year. We will be lucky to get a quarter of that.
It's a dollar. It was $1.50 per resident of the district. Prior to that, it was $1.25. Mm-hmm. So maybe a dollar. Maybe it's $1.05 because it was around $58.
So what I was going to put in for is additional technology supplies, and we had this past year was technology, world languages, and marketing. And we were talking about we still are planning to shrink wrap the van and get our, since it's just going around, it's very anonymous little van currently, so we could be advertising the library out there. So that's this year's.
I'm sorry. You're going to shrink wrap the van?
The van.
With graphics.
That says, right now it has letters this big that say, not a public library.
The Christmas.
Well, air breathing tubes.
Sure, that would be great.
The Christmas free bus.
Yeah.
Okay.
The Christmas free bus.
Yeah, correct.
That's right.
Right now, when they see the army on the call, please.
I haven't seen
the
Christmas
And then I thought I would put in one more part for materials, just because you can always use more money for materials.
Would you have to be more specific, like saying print or ebook?
And I think that they are okay with it being pretty loose.
Oh, good. Okay.
But you then have to report up the next year on what you did.
Sure.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That was what I needed to say so that we could qualify to apply for the protective grant.
Okay.
But I am interested to hear any more thoughts that you might.
Okay, next on the agenda is unfinished business. Entertain a motion to approve item A, the recommended changes of policy 4.02, appointment.
So moved.
Karen?
I might as well second.
Second.
Patty?
Dennis, I think everybody made a recommendation on the issue of whether the board or the director are in charge of hiring the staff.
Yeah, I provided Susan with my written opinion on that. I don't know if that's going to be shared with the board or not.
Well,
really what it comes down to, the question was, because the statute as it reads says that the administrator may hire other employees deemed necessary by the administrator to fix their compensation and remove those employees subject to the approval of the board's report.
It's definitely an interpretation that I've never heard of. A board always approves hiring, and I appreciate the attorney's opinion, but again, the statute states you interview, you select them, and you bring them to the board for final approval. I have never heard of a board that doesn't do this.
Well, he's the deputy, director of the state library, and his boss talked to the boss of Rails on this same issue, mm-hmm. and she said that he told the person that called that he's not a lawyer and that you should consult our lawyer.
What he told me was lawyers can do whatever they want. If he wants to look up case law and decide to choose that if a judge overturned it, he's going to go with it. That's his call.
You are following the law. You are approving right now. You're pre-approving. If you adopt the policy itself, you are following what the law says. You're giving approval to the director now by adopting this policy. So it's not inconsistent with...
The policy is inconsistent with the statute. The statute says we approve.
You are
approved. It says right here.
I know.
Subject to the approval of the board.
Correct. And what I'm suggesting to you is mm-hmm. if you adopt the policy, you are approving, you're pre-approving the hires and giving the director, delegating to her the authority to make the decision of who's she's
hiring. And the reason why that is still against what the statute says, the process of hiring is the person is hired after the board meeting and approval takes place by the board. Then the employee does receive their letter that indicates they were hired. That's the way the law has been forever.
I would disagree. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think what you're saying is that the statute says yes, the board should approve the candidate, but the board can do that by delegating its authority to the director.
Correct.
And since pre-approving the candidates that she may choose to hire, and in that way still be in conformance with the statute. And I think what you're saying is that we can choose to adopt that policy or choose not to adopt that policy.
Correct.
And either way, we'd be in conformance with the statute.
Correct.
Correct?
Yes.
And as some of us recall, we verbally gave our director the authority to do that earlier this year. Now, we can revisit that, but
is it in the
that's what we're doing right now.
That's what I recall we decided last June. But you know, we can look at that policy again.
Right.
Right.
Right. Can I ask, the main reason that this was brought up was because of the fact we meet once a month and it delays the offering of somebody the job. So therefore, it's likely they could be elsewhere. Is that the main reason?
That is one of the reasons. Another reason, though, is just that it's the library staff who has interviewed the person, gone through the resumes, and knows what the needs of the position are. It's really not a thing that the board would have the knowledge of as much.
But because the board's responsible for fixing compensation and the revenues and the way they're spent, that's why we just have the authority to do that.
The law statutes, if I may just say one more thing, they also say that the board has sole and exclusive use of the library's funds, and the board has the complete control over the building and the grounds, and you've delegated those things to me. So I don't see where this is a different thing particularly.
But is it delegation of spend or just delegation? Oh, I'm sorry.
Just regarding that point, under appointments, this is also 4.02, states that the library director is authorized to hire at a salary 25% above the minimum of a range for open positions. So it's my understanding if you wanted to hire someone, if a director wanted to hire someone with more than 25%, that would have to come before us.
Really?
So, you know, if you wanted to even hit the mid-range of the 50% range of the director's salary, our director would have to come to us and ask, can I pay that amount of money? And she wouldn't be able to do that without our pre-approval.
Right, I did not take that out.
Right, so if I just have some clarification on that, that would mean, say you have, let's just say a librarian, they come in with 10 years of experience, you would possibly want to do more of a mid-range of that, so that would have to come to the board approval,
correct.
Because that would be over that piece.
Correct.
Okay, so, all right. So, okay. So Nat, do you have any questions?
We just did that salary minimum maximum. So
but this is a different piece.
It should be higher 25% over.
Over the minimum of that range, right. I mean, that's how it's always been.
Which would not
but I'm not suggesting that that change. I'm saying if I want to hire somebody at more than the minimum, more than 25% over the minimum, I would come to you and say so.
So she really only has the authority to hire someone at the low end of the range without pre-approval.
What's the purpose of the minimum and maximum? Are they contradicting each other?
We just agree.
Purpose of the minimum maximum is a range for any particular salary in a particular position.
But she cannot hire someone within the minimum maximum.
No. More than 25% over the minimum without our approval.
So if the minimum's a dollar, I can't hire somebody, and the maximum is $3, I can't hire somebody for more than $1.25 without coming and asking you.
So it's a sort of a check on the salary that is
Okay.
that person.
Well, of course, yes, let's just go around.
And
Tim, do you have any?
Sure. I like authorizing the director to do their job, to do the hiring. I have found in my experience as a manager that the best policy is to hire the best person and let them do their job without looking over their shoulder and letting them really have the authority to do what they need to do. I don't have an objection to allowing our director to hire staff as she sees fit.
I feel the statement that the library staff knows best what the library needs is an accurate statement. I mean, I can't profess to know what is needed in a new hire. With that, because I don't work the library. I have no idea.
Okay. I actually had a question, and this is regarding another proposed change to 4.02. And I see that the first paragraph is lined up beginning with openings. And I'm just wondering what is the purpose of looking out there, paragraph.
The first one?
Yeah.
It is the an opening occurs upon the intent of the board to fill the position or upon the creation of a new position. I thought that the intent of the board to fill the position meant that I would have to come to the board and say, I want to fill this position. That was why. Maybe it could be reworded to not imply that.
Well, you know, I guess I was just interested in a little clarity in terms of when the director is hiring to replace someone, I think the director ought to have the discretion to go ahead and make that offer, particularly if that director can only offer a salary which is at the low end of the range. I think the director should have the discretion to do that. But when it comes to creating new positions, any new positions that may not previously exist, I think the board should have some input into that.
Okay.
And I do think there is a reason when you're filling a position to have the discretion to do that, to make that offer fairly quickly, because I'm afraid we might lose some good candidates if you have to wait until the next board meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Do we need some sort of a level on that, though? We have positions of fairly low level people who are filling books and all that kind of stuff. Do we need to maybe? Because that's not a bad idea to have approval for new positions, but maybe it should be up at a certain level.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm not sure how to.
I don't know how to write.
Full-time positions.
Right.
They
come and go, and you know, you don't want to tie their hands too much on the small stuff.
Yeah, I mean, I will say that. These days, with technology changing and the different roles in the library changing, it's really turning very fast. And jobs are quite often getting tweaked, and I'll use the example of the webmaster position that's now open. Sasha looked at the job description and he wanted to change a few things about that job. He wanted it to have some other responsibilities along with webmaster. So we tweaked it and he listed it in a slightly different way, and it has a slightly different title. So if we did, I guess I would really prefer to have it set up so that I just let you know, as I currently do, what we're doing, you know, what's going on, rather than I would have to come and you know, not list that job until I got your approval. That's, I mean, I really, when I did give you the results of the FASTFAP survey and there were the 42 libraries, they all said the board has no role in hiring, other than hiring the director. And I honestly, I think that is appropriate, but if that's what you feel like you need, then, you know, of course, I will do whatever the board votes.
You know, in that we are approving the budget, we're setting the limit of what the amount that can be spent. That constrains hires to within that amount. Within that area, it really should be up to the director to decide how she or he wants to fill those positions in order to run the library.
Can I just ask you one question? I know you work for a school district, and there are many, many, many directors in your school, I'm sure. And they hire constantly. Not one director hires them until the board approves them at the upcoming board meeting. And the interviewing process and the offer and everything is set up to meet that board meeting date. And yet, your school hasn't lost incredible teachers or administrators. So I'm trying to figure out why it's a problem for us.
Well, it's a little different. I think you're not comparing apples to apples, actually, because most of our hiring is done during the summer and at the end of May because of the new school year.
Most of it is.
Well, there's still hires throughout the year.
Very little.
But what I'm saying is no one has the authority but your board to hire. And that's when the letters go out.
Right, that's for the school district.
And they're from some very hefty salary position, I'm sure.
Right, but the board isn't set anything. It's all given. It is all given to them.
Given what?
All, everything. They're not in charge of any of the applications. They're not in charge of
anything. Oh, no, I know. What I'm saying is that person isn't hired until it's through the board meeting.
Right.
And that Monday or Tuesday or whatever.
Right.
And if you run an entire school, that's not that comes.
Well, I worked at Glenbrook North, and I applied for a job, and I got it like days later. I'm sure it's going to go back to work.
Oh, it has.
Well, actually, it all depends because my daughter was substitute, and she didn't have to go to the board. That was not. There's certain positions that are not.
Yeah, I know those.
Does not have to be board approved.
I mean, I know.
Yeah,
I doubt it.
I'm telling you that.
Right.
I know everything goes to the board. It does depend because I know she was able to work.
She just, as long as she got fingerprinted and she went through her testing, she was in.
But that's probably different. That's just substitute. It's not
right.
Full-time.
I'm just saying. So I'm really, honestly, I'm not sure part-time stuff. I didn't really look into it. I don't know.
Yeah, well, I think she's not really
sure.
A higher level position, I'm sure.
To be honest, I guess I'm really not because I really don't know.
I've been involved at that level for years.
But I did ask Steve, and he says the village board doesn't approve any of his hires, right?
We do salaries. They tell us, the directors, we reappoint them every year. They're reappointed. So. And we have to approve them. Anyways. So the only thing that I just don't think, why are we here? I mean, we're supposed to be watching over the budget and watching the money. And I apologize, I just don't remember approving in June. You could be right, I don't remember whatsoever, but not sure which position, but I guess when someone is hired, we weren't told with the salary. I read in the director's report. It was the first time I saw the salary, so.
You know, there's been a lot that's gone on since June, so to be honest with you, it's understandable if you don't remember.
But I think something like that.
Okay, so still on the table, we have to approve the item A, the recommended changes to policy 4.02 appointment. So you can just go and review it.
Okay.
we allowed to make a change if anybody wanted to? I mean, or do we do it just as is? Obviously, we can do it as is.
You can do it anywhere you want.
Okay.
If you want to, if there's a suggestion on changing the language, it's your policy. You can say what you want to say as far as it conforms to the law.
Is there anything that anyone is wants for sure changes? You want the full time in there? Anything? Just leave it the way it is for right now. Let's go around and see what we have. And all right, then I guess we'll just take a roll for as is. Karen.
The library will be closing in 5 minutes. Maybe you can get the races
yes.
All right. Please do so now. There's a great call.
Carolyn?
To be checked out.
No.
Service of lobby.
Jeanette?
No.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
I promise I will keep you very political. No intention of operating in the dark.
I don't think you need us.
Well, the role of the board is to help set the vision and the whole strategic planning process is where your role is.
Next on the agenda is unfinished business. I will entertain a motion to approve item B, which is recommended policy change to 4.10, leaves of the absence without pay. There was a question at the last meeting about the wording regarding military absences, and we all got Dennis's memo on this. Any further discussion?
No, the simple explanation is it conforms with the recent and prior Department of Labor regulations to deal with military families and entitlements for specific family members. So it's consistent with what the Department of Labor requires at this point.
So what in here is what we're voting at? Is the yellow coming
the
out?
The yellow is new, and it's the result of the changes in the regulations by the Department of Labor.
Right. Okay.
Whatever.
All right. Got it. Okay.
Yeah. I'm just wondering, because the regulations change periodically, I just wonder, should we just say we'll grant them medical aid according to the regulations?
Yes.
In conformance with the law? I don't know. I mean, it doesn't tell employees much when they're looking at the policy manual, which is a problem, but it's out of our control whether or not the Department of Labor changes these regulations again. And we have to follow them whether we want to or not.
Mm-hmm.
I agree.
Yes.
I agree with you also.
We can certainly simplify it. And I think you're right. I think an employee is not going to really understand looking at a blanket statement that we're going to comply with all the rules and regulations from the Department of Labor, what those are. But maybe we can provide them with the guidance for the document.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Is that the administrative staff would be.
Right. But from a so that you don't have to keep changing this policy every time that the Department of Labor makes a change in the regulations.
Shall we take a look at it then again and
reword it for
We could just say something like all eligible employees are entitled to family medical leave as required by law or something like that.
Department of Labor.
We'll bring something back next.
So then this is put aside until
correct. Why don't we have a motion to table this one for the next regular board meeting?
I move to table.
I second.
Okay, Karen and Patty move to table item 12B.
Yeah.
To the next regular board meeting.
To the next regular board meeting in January 2016. Next item on our
Thank you.
You're watching it there, dear.
Discussion and then roll call.
Any discussion? Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Yeah.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Just
stepped out. Okay, next is 12C, Library Retirement Plan Investigation. Review of the local pensions.
So I have a presentation that's, hopefully it's brief. It's to discuss local pensions that we've been talking about in some of the past meetings and during public comments. Why is it an important subject? It's been referenced several times in public comment. The Village of Niles pension plans are significantly underfunded. This is according to their latest comprehensive annual financial report. Police pension plan is only funded at 42.15%, $41 million underfunded. Firefighters, 45.37%, or $36 million underfunded. And the total for these two plans underfunded is $77,500,000.
That's at the state level, total state level?
Village of Niles.
Just the Village of Niles?
Yeah.
Police
yeah.
and fire only.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it's Village of Niles.
Village
of Niles. Mm-hmm.
Oh,
that's where we raised taxes.
So the funding levels of these plans have been used repeatedly to warn us about what might happen to the library that adopts its own plan. I thought I'd start with some definitions of what funded status is so we understand what we're talking about. Basically, the simplest definition is that the funded status is the difference between plan assets and plan liabilities. In order to determine plan assets, what the actuaries do is they look at liquidation value of a portfolio, but try not to have it be in a fire sale liquidation methodology where you're taking any price that you can get but have an orderly liquidation. Okay. So generally, when that happens, you end up with values that are slightly higher than the market values, maybe 4 to 5%. The liability side is more complex. You have to look at age of new employees, what mortality tables or life expectancy is. You have to look at investment returns currently and projected into the future. Contribution levels, salary increases, also benefit levels, and what the payouts to the pensioners are. Using, of course, actuaries use approved methodologies to combine all of these factors to develop the present value of the pension liability. So the pension liability is supposed, in a report, is supposed to be today. What is my pension liability for all of my payments in the future? So all of the factors that we were looking at on the previous slide are determined by an organization's policies, experience, and plans. And each calculation is only unique for that particular point in time. The factors, they can change significantly over time. You can increase benefits, which has an upward pressure on the liability. You could change your staffing levels, you could decrease them, which would have a downward pressure on the liability. Investment returns could increase or decrease, which would have pressure on the liability as well. And the salary schedules could increase, which might put upward pressure on the liability. Just as some examples. If you look at all of the village's pension liabilities, or pension plans, I should say, including IMRF for clerical people in the village, police and firefighters separately. Excuse me. The actual accrued liability is about $175 million, of which the village has $89 million to pay for it. And that leaves $85 million, which needs to be provided. So, said a different way, the funded ratio is about 51%. Okay?
Is it
for
year?
For the total.
For the total.
For the
total.
The average, so it's premium.
For the total. So if, you know, you have three different plans and you have three different funded ratios. And basically what I did was I added the, you know, the first three rows of numbers to, you know, to get the 175, the 89, and the 85, okay? And then I divided the 89, which is the value of the plan assets, by the liability, which says that we have, or the village has, 51% of the money available to pay the present value of its pension obligations.
Did the state just mandate that you had to have only 50%?
No.
We have to have it fully funded by...
Okay, maybe that's it.
So, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
So, IMRF, my understanding that IMRF on a whole is funded to 97%.
Yeah, 93%.
Okay, 92. So that means the village of Niles is remiss further than what the entire IMRF. Okay.
I wouldn't say remiss, but we'll see what kinds of things happen.
I guess I didn't think that could happen. I thought IMRF was such that if your funding level was falling, you would increase your rate to make sure you stayed close to the target rate.
They do.
So
natural question is, how do we get into this condition where police and fire are somewhere around 40-something%, 43-44% funded, IMRF is 77% funded? If we look back to 2002, we could see, if we read across the bottom, that the IMRF was 103% funded. Firefighters was 107% funded, and police pension was about 86% funded. If you add them all up, you can see that the unfunded liability was about $1.8 million, which means that they were like almost 98% funded. Okay, so the good old days, all right? So the next question would be, what happened between 2002 and the current day? Okay. A few readily identifiable things happened. Post 9/11, police and firefighters plans significantly increased their benefits. This was around 2004. Based on the data, which is all what I pulled from the comprehensive annual financial reports for the last 17 years or so, increased the liability by approximately 16%, or around $10 million. Also between 2002 and 2010, the police and firefighters' pension contributions were shorted by approximately $13 million. The village still paid $13 million over that period of time, but they should have paid $26 million. And this increased liabilities by approximately $32 million. Okay, now the reason that it's higher is because that money has not been working for the village in an investment portfolio for all that period of time, besides being, you know, being a short on the investment. In 2010, the village had an early retirement incentive plan, which resulted in 18 employees covered by IMRF to retire sooner than they anticipated. So what that does is it takes the money which is being planned to be paid out in 10 years and pulls that forward. So instead of having the chance to take money, you know, to take a sum and earn up to that amount, you got to pay it now. Okay.
That's the rule.
And then of course we had the 2008-2009 financial crisis. Which, based on my estimates, accounted for about 25% of the total additional liabilities, or $11 million, out of the $44 million total. Okay, so here's just a little summary right here of the of the different things we talked about in the last two slides. Increased benefits were a yes here for the police and firefighters. Shorted contributions were a yes for police and firefighters, but not Neither one of those apply to IMRF. The next two, early retirement incentive, does apply to IMRF, but not to police or firefighters. And then, of course, the financial crisis affected everything across the board. What this is a funded ratio going from 1998 to 2013. So you can see over here in the early years, we're above 100%. And then we start to slide. This is the point at which the contribution shortfall starts. And then you can see that the other arrow is here for that particular item. So that, you know, it's been quite a, you know, quite a long time that we were shorting the contributions that had to be made or were recommended to be made. And the village had chosen for some reason not to do that. Here is the 2004, and you can see the drop right here. The 2004 increased benefits for police and fire, which, you know, basically it causes the liability to increase, and therefore your funded percent, your funded ratio to decrease. The financial crisis, you know, kind of is along this area of the curve right here. You know, so that's easy to understand. And then here, along this part of the curve, is where the early retirement comes in and the revaluation of the of IMRF is impacted. Wow.
So we're starting to go the other direction in the last couple of years.
Yeah, down here, you know, we're starting to go back up. In the most recent years, the village has been contributing more than what the recommended contribution rate is, okay? Okay, so this is largely the same information. I know it looks like it's a mess, but it's by individual plan. So the blue line is IMRF, the orange line is police, and the purple line is the firefighters, okay? So you can see in the early part that firefighters and IMRF were above 100%, okay? Police were bumping around 90%, started to decrease slowly. This point and this point on those two curves is where the contribution shortfall started and then ended here. So you can kind of see there's a long slide on each one of those curves. If we look over here, we have the increased police and fire benefits, which, you know, took this gentle slope from the low contributions and just, you know, made it more dramatic. If we look at the financial crisis, you know, obviously, starting here approximately for IMRF, you see the slide, it ends here, it's 2008-2009, over the same period. You know, for the police and the fire, they weren't as impacted, so they must have been perhaps invested a little bit more conservatively, would be a natural conclusion to draw there. Here is the part of the curve where you have the early retirement, you know, so, you know, it impacted IMRF somewhat, but, you know, not as dramatically as some of the other things. And then from this point forward, you could see IMRF recovering nicely, while police and fire, you know, continue to have their issues. I'm not sure what other events, you know, occurred in this time frame to, you know, create these curves, but, you know, maybe they were more conservatively invested and didn't get a chance to take advantage of the market upturn that, you know, started in this area here. So we see that pension plan funded status could be affected by numerous things. Some of the items are not controllable, like the financial crisis isn't controllable except by everybody who made money on it in New York. Things like life expectancy or mortality tables, that's not something that, you know, that's necessarily controllable at this level. A lot of the items that affect pensions are controllable. You know, like making full or partial contributions, benefit levels, early retirement offering, staffing levels, salary increases, and investment returns. So that's the presentation. The whole idea was to just to add some context to what we're talking about when we talk about the village and its pension plans. I would hazard to guess that most of the municipalities, we could just change the name from Niles to Mount Prospect to Skokie to Chicago, because the 2004 benefit increases were statewide. They were negotiated at the state level. Although I can't speak to contribution shortfalls, you know, for every municipality. That's
based on what's going on. Sure.
Okay. Any questions?
Yes. That's my question. I'm surprised that the IMRF fund, which is always going to be the best funder, I'm surprised it's sunk to even 77%. I understand the factors that would make that happen, but I thought the IMRF officials would come in and say to the village or whoever had to buy it, you need to raise your rate next year to bring it back up. And I thought that would happen to prevent it even from falling as much as it did.
Okay, so what the IMRF does is they look at payouts and cash flow and things of that nature, what they expect over the next year, and use that in large part to determine what your contribution is going to be. Mm-hmm. So, for example, if we go back to and when they have large market changes. Mm-hmm. They don't try to recover that immediately. They recover that over time. They amortize it.
Okay, I see. So they realize it might take some time to get you back up to
97%. Okay. Down to this point here. So just above 70. And part of what the village pays every year is to amortize those losses and try to recover.
I see.
Any other questions? Okay, that's what I got. Thank you.
I just have one answer. Karen, when you just said that you thought that the IMRF would tell the police and the fire.
No, not the police and fire, just IMRF.
Oh, okay.
All right, so.
Can I just make one IMRF comment, though? IMRF, I get the impression everyone feels they're so sound. The problem with IMRF is that you are obligated to make those payments, whether you're taking them from somewhere else or not.
Yes.
Other pensions, when the economy's horrible or we don't get the tax revenue we expect, you just don't make the payments. In IMRF, you have got to take it from somewhere, and that's why everyone is suffering. So it's not a great idea.
Well, there's legislative changes going on right now that are forcing funding levels up.
They put IMRF in tier levels too, which I think is helping.
Yeah, that's different. So there's two classes of entrance, and other pensions have done similar things, not necessarily police and fire yet at this point.
But what I'm trying to say is there's no getting out of IMRF, and once you sign up for that, you're stuck for life. So it's an expense we really, really need to look at.
Mm-hmm.
And everyone's drowning that participates.
Yeah. Well, all this was intended to do is provide context for the conversation around the funded ratio levels of the village and other pension plans around us. It's not a piece for or against let's understand what we're talking about.
And then I have a question about the police and the fire departments. I'm not familiar with their pensions or who they are or how they're organized, but when times are tough, can whatever their pension fund is withstand lower contributions and it's okay?
Well, what happens...
I mean, I know you can't withstand...
What happens is, you know, actuarially... When they do the actuarial determination, your funded ratio slides and gets worse. And that's exactly what this is. This was a contribution shortfall. So in several years, the village would pay, let's say, $500,000 when they should have paid $1.5 million. So they were short by $1 million. Can you do it? Well, clearly in this area, in this period, they did do it.
And I guess
the legislative changes will be to force them not to do that, I don't know.
Oh, okay. Because in a way, during those years, the economy was horrible in Niles. So what they were doing was taking the money out of there and putting it in something else. But we don't have that flexibility with IMRF, I believe. So not that you don't want to end up underfunded.
They paid IMRF every year.
Yes.
As I said.
Yes.
So. We have already heard about what our pension or so-called pension is here in the Niles Public Library. We've seen kind of how we can, or how IMRF compares to the fire and police. And what Carolyn's saying, a lot of things I really don't know about because I don't have IMRF. So I think we really need to have a cost study made, let everyone understand what IMRF is, and then because we need to have all the information in order to make the decision. So I think we, as a board, should direct Susan and Greg to actually have IMRF do a cost study and have them also come and talk with us so we can compare every single thing and make the best decision.
By a cost study? What do you mean by that? I mean, these are
to see how much it would cost us
to actually
so we're get down to the nitty gritty and know what to expect, so we could actually make the best decision.
By that, they're looking at the ages of our employees.
I would think they would use all the best data that.
I think it's about.
We also need to, I assume, query the
staff.
Right, to find out.
You know what might be good too is have them actually talk with the staff to inform them, maybe not only inform us, but also talk with the staff and maybe have two discussions.
Could they provide?
Because they already know what they have.
Correct.
And I think they really need to know how it would impact them.
Correct.
Right. So yeah, that's a really good idea.
And someone would give them specifics, like if this person who makes $60,000, with IMRF, it would cost you.
Right.
So
right.
They would
give
really
individual
like that.
Right. Right.
Okay. Yeah,
well,
I think both would be the best.
Okay.
So
just to make sure that everybody has the same expectations, once you tell IMRF to go. They estimate 8 to 12 weeks to get a return on the cost study. Okay, so without actually knowing what those numbers are, and it's going to probably take us out to the end of March, possibly maybe mid-March or thereabouts, and at that point
it takes us what it takes.
Yeah, well, I just want to make sure everybody has expectations.
Yeah, I didn't really know that, but yeah.
Because I really
and in the meantime, we can have the IMRF representatives come here and talk about the plan from their perspective.
Not with respect to what
because,
exactly.
I don't know if IMRF is going to be the best decision. I don't know what's going to be the best decision until we hear from everyone.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Right.
What was the name of the gentleman who came in touch with our current plan?
George Pantazis.
Right. I remember him speaking to us. Did he give us any kind of handout or anything regarding?
I don't believe he did.
I generally recall what we do, but I can't remember what we do with respect to part-time people.
That would be all our information more than his, so
okay.
we can give you that information.
If you could, I've seen that before repeatedly, but if I could just have it in writing again to just sort of refer to, I appreciate it. I just can't remember all the details of what we do now.
Okay. All right, well, thank you for all the information, Greg. Appreciate it. The next agenda item is to go into executive session to discuss the appointment, employment, compensation, discipline, performance, or dismissal of specific employees of the Niles Public Library District, to discuss minutes of closed session meetings. Do I have a motion?
I move.
Tim?
Second.
Did not.
Thank you.
how we change that, where they weren't moved to the building now? What was the leave in the building?
So, Mayor, I
mean, it's going to be under lock.
Well, Chris Ball had all the years and years worth of the recordings.
Right, I remember that.
So now they're a little safe.
Right, so that's why I thought they weren't moved.
But I'll just mail it off our house, and then she'll return it.
That's not right.
I just not turned it off.
Okay.
You let her know, you expect her to know if I got on the tape or not, and you did it at 10:27.
10:27?
Yeah. I'll put it on the tape.
Okay, I'll put it down.
The time is now, okay, wait, we have to go back.
Meeting's next to be at 10:30.
Okay, I have to go back to the first one. Okay, well, I'll just turn it.
You're not going to be final action.
Okay. All right, time is now 10:27, and we are reconvening the regular meeting at the Mount Public Library District Board of Trustees. Today, I'm Lisa Jerome.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Here.
Jeanette?
Here.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Here.
Tim?
Okay, for executive session action.
The board, just for the record, the board discussed certain goals with the library director. We'll have to show you the next year. Among other things, among other personal issues.
Okay.
Related to specific employees.
I don't think we need a motion to adjourn.
We're done?
Yes, motion.
Okay, a motion to adjourn.
Okay, no, we are.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I just hit two things. Does anyone else have another?
Yeah.
Oh, you do, go ahead.
Well, I just have one. I have one thing. You can go first, go ahead.
I wanted to get together with Greg and see if we could come up with a change in our check register report. I mentioned that we have two columns. One's accounts payable, one's computer check. And I know I'm always asking questions about why this, what's that check for, and what have you. And I get there's a box somewhere, but what I would like is if there was more information on this report, then 3 months from now I could look at things and compare things. And what I have here is it's a report from some other place in California. But what they do, for example, is either it's a transaction number or a check number. This is the name of the person who the check or company is written to. And then this is a description. And it says here it was for vision or dental, or it was for books in the library, or it says, you know, communications, but or it could be travel. But there would be a description next to the name of the check. So I kind of know, like, are they computers or technology or something? And then I thought, in the second column, how do we reference information in the library? We don't use budget accounts or budget account numbers, right? You use your line items from your...
Chart of accounts.
Okay. So can we use that as well? Like, that would be the line item that it refers to?
Yeah. I'm actually working on something. It's hard to get all of the information because it's from a couple of different areas in the database. So
that's gonna be my next question. How is this report even compiled?
Yeah, well, I mean, you have to do it, reconcile it. I'll have something next time.
Okay.
I'll show it to you.
Just because it just would make it a lot easier, and then I would ask so many questions.
Yeah, he does have it another way. He showed it to Tim, and
okay,
it's just that it doesn't quite have everything on it that it needs.
Okay, just so that we can, like...
But I like that suggestion of relating it to the budget. I'll let him, that's kind of...
Okay, good. And then I have one other question, and it's really for you, Greg, as well. It was regarding the ordinance 1507. And it was for the increase of the levy, which I understood to mean we were raising the levy $800,000. So what I did was I took this this ordinance 1507, and I compared it to, I guess it was 1505, which was July 1st, 2015 through June 30th, 2016, which was the beginning. And then I just assumed these increases raised the tax levy. These numbers subtracted from this number would give me 800,000, but it's over.
Okay, so there's two concepts. 1505 is the expense side, and 1507 is the revenue side. So what 1505 says is there's a legal spending limit called the appropriation, which is 12 million and something. I don't remember the exact number because that'll
be
the other
column.
And the budget that management is going to live by is
half of that.
Is approximately half of that.
Mm-hmm.
In 1507, what we did was we repeated the appropriation, and which I think is the center column. Yeah. So here's the appropriation right here.
Mm-hmm.
And this should be equal to this, except for the per capita grant, which falls out altogether. And then this is the amount to be raised by levy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and so this is our revenue line.
Right, so I subtracted, go ahead.
And if you go all the way down to here,
mm-hmm.
this is the total amount of the levy, in spite of what people like Tom Rapp say. And this is $800,000 more than what it was last year.
Okay, so somehow then, if I took this line item, the increase in the levy was 3586. It was
No. This is the amount. This 3586 is the amount of this 6373 to be raised by levy.
Okay, so because this is 63 and this was 62, that's why this went up higher than 800,000 total. That would be the ordinance we started the year with. So I just took the budget line item from there and subtracted it from the raised levy, which is the new budget line item. And the numbers came over 800,000.
By how much?
913.
Well, no. You can't compare this. You can't compare this to this. Yeah, this is the revenue column.
Okay, revenue meaning that's not the budget line item.
No. It has nothing to do with the budget.
Why? So then, you're raising the tax levy 3586, 186 for salaries. Where is the line in salaries that I should be comparing it to?
You won't be able to. You can't.
You're increasing salaries by how much?
Why is this? Oh, this is off by 150, which is the increase. This must not be a final copy.
Okay, well, these are the two copies that I compared, so that's why I had all these questions.
Yeah, this isn't the final. This is not the final.
Okay, so that's why these numbers.
This number is 6370. It's exactly 150 off, which was, if you remember, we raised the budget,
mm-hmm.
And actually the budget is 35, 86, 862, and the total salaries is 6373724, so there's $150,000 difference here and $75,000 difference here. So this is before the line item was changed.
Okay, but right. What you're saying is this item, this column here, raised by tax levy, is now, it's called expenses, it's not relative to the initial budget.
That's the revenue.
It's revenue.
Yeah, this is the tax revenue that we expect to get.
Okay, and this line item was, this was not the tax revenue?
No, that's the budget. That's the expenditure level.
Okay, so now, if that's expenditure level, and now it's at 3586, this is the increase.
No, here's how you find the $800,000. You take this amount right here.
Mm-hmm. Which was the result of all of this.
Yeah, which is a summary of these two pages.
Right.
Okay. And you subtract from it
last year's tax levy, which was $5,918,747.
Last year, 2014, 2013-14. Okay.
So you subtract the $5,918,747.
And that's where I'll see the $800,000.
And the difference will be $800,000.
Okay, I thought the increase was based on the, okay, that's why. All right, thank you for explaining all that.
That's all I have.
Well, I'll put it on the agenda for next month, but one thing I wanted to bring up, and I did receive the policy manual, so this is all fact, but when we were talking about reimbursements, and last meeting Greg said, do you really think the IRS cares if you eat, you know, what you eat for lunch? Right in our policy it states
that they do.
Itemized receipts for all expenses over $5 must be submitted. Our policy also states that alcohol is not reimbursed. So if someone does not give you itemized, how do we know there's not alcohol on there? But I'm saying, so we went, you know, this is our policy. Because I did see some of the reimbursement, that's what brought it to my attention, that it was just dollar amount and signature. So, which shouldn't be. And then, one thing I wanted to ask, because it also says in here that if a trip is canceled and expenses are incurred, the employee has to reimburse. So, I guess what I'm asking, and I'm assuming that goes for trustees too. So I guess if there's functions that the library pays for and the trustee does not attend, are the taxpayers absorbing that expense or are the trustees reimbursing that expense?
Historically, I don't think the trustees have reimbursed it ever. It does come up quite often.
Oh, I've always gone. I've never I always see it. Or I would have reimbursed if that were me, but I know for a fact that. Okay, asking that.
Well, maybe we should make a decision not to do that anymore. If she said it comes up.
Well, it kind of is up to you. I mean, it's not up to me whether I can't tell a trustee you must repay this.
I don't see why not.
Well,
Why don't we put this on next month?
Is it just the expense policy, or are there other ones?
I haven't looked through it all, but no. That was the one I wanted to bring up, where you know you said the IRS would care less, but it's right in our policy. Itemized.
Well, that's different than the IRS. That's different than the Internal Revenue Code.
But our policy. So change our policy because we're going against. In other words, burn this because we're not doing anything. We're not following policy on anything. Throw in your fireplace, but we're not doing it.
Well, I think we either should follow it or change it, one or the other. So,
exactly.
Right. That's what I think we had to talk. I don't think we can make that change tonight anyway.
I mean, I didn't run across other ones. I just happened when we were bringing up change in bylaws. That's
sure.
why I asked for the policy manual to see.
Okay. All right. Any other policies that we gotta look at?
Participation at meetings for, because I know a lot of times we always compare. Well, the village does. So I don't know if you pick and choose what you want to mayor the village, but I don't think it's fair that if residents come here and want to talk, they're paying your salary, and if they stop it, you'll be on the unemployment line. So.
And I don't understand why.
Because 5 minutes net limit of 30 minutes, meaning 7 people can talk and the rest of the residents go home.
But don't be mad at me.
It's not my policy.
It's the board policy.
But we can, if we would have had all those residents, we could have we could have changed that night and said everybody can talk, because the village, we do not have.
We did let everybody talk.
But that was the big one, but.
No, obviously, we've never denied anyone the whole time.
No, but you would have, you were gonna stop.
It, didn't it run over half an hour?
No.
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 It did.
It did, it did, yeah.
It did.
No, I think the idea was just to kind of establish to people, okay, you have some framework on this, you can't just get up here and showboat for 20 minutes.
Well, no.
But, so it just kind of sets it out, and then we left early.
I didn't pay for 5 minutes per, no, I'm not saying let them talk till they're.
So we never.
So, just, so we have another policy that we need to talk about again?
Yeah, because like the village, if we have one speaker or 100 speakers, they all talk. I mean, so that policy should be changed.
However, the village does, doesn't the village say if you are, have repetitive comments, we can limit those?
We let them do it though.
But the village says we can limit those.
Yeah, I think you say.
Because you don't want 100 people come up and each person say exactly the same thing.
We do say that, we're like, if you hear someone saying, don't come up and say the same thing over.
So that's reasonable.
You know, there are people that do and we let them talk, so. I mean, they do, I'll admit, yes, they do, they say the same thing over and over again, so.
Okay, and then I just got one last thing, and I just wanted to kind of pass these out too, so everyone has a copy. Yes, so, and I just kind of highlighted, because this has come up in the past, about if we have questions, to any staff or administration, that it shouldn't really be over 5 minutes of time or should be brought to the board. And I believe Jeanette, you even said last month that all questions should be asked here for transparency.
Mm-hmm.
And during the last month, one of our board members has had the library administrative staff retrieving and copying invoice for past payments. These payments, like every other payment made by the library, are available for each month for to be looked at with access. And that's a chance to review the support for each check written during the month. There were 24 items on the list which amounted to all of this paperwork, which was 20 hours worth of work for an employee. And we discussed putting a limit on that amount of time. And I don't know how that ever changed. It was always, you know, if it's 5 minutes, so I would always say, Linda, is this a question that's only gonna take you 5 minutes? And somehow now we're back to asking a lot of information. So I think and maybe this is something we need to change and put on our agenda for next week or next month.
What do we need to change?
Yeah, what?
I don't know, or maybe make a policy that a board member, like it suggests here on this trustee corner, it says, it is important to remember that while individual trustees are important members of the board, it is the board as a whole that is legally responsible for library operations. And then it goes down to say, the same time board meetings are the appropriate place for members to raise questions and make requests, rather than bringing issues up to staff members or library administration on an individual basis. I think we have to mirror that. So we can decide as a whole, do we need this information, and for what reason do we need this information, and is it appropriate for our staff time to be taken for that information to be gathered?
I'd like
I think
to
we should do that as
that.
A whole.
One, I didn't ask anyone in their right mind who would think to make these copies is not looking at this library in the right light in terms of management, in terms of payroll hours, just the sheer waste of time. I asked to come into the library and look at backup for accounts payable because there were certain things I wanted to view. I wanted to get an idea of what we were doing and bring suggestions to the board. I was told no problem. First I was supposed to talk to Greg. Then I was supposed to make an appointment with Kathy Joy, which I did. I sent her an email and asked if I can make an appointment. Susan told me when she was free. And then I get an email that says, I'm not supposed to email Kathy Toy when I was told to email Kathy Toy. Then Susan said she had reviewed the policy, and according to our bylaws, if you request to view information, all these copies need to be made, and every other board member needs to get copies. And I responded to her telling her, if based on your experience knowledge, you think this is the best way to handle my request, then go right ahead.
Okay.
This is absurd that anyone would do this. And why is a board member, if I'm looking at technology, or if I'm looking at travel, or I want to figure out how we're doing this or that, so I could bring recommendations to the board, why can't I look at a folder? I'm not a criminal, but to do this, I can't believe anyone would think to even do that and waste all our staff's time.
But I saw the list, there were 24 items on that list. With 6 months, you wanted backup of six.
Okay, and that's because I want to review the databases, and I want to review other stuff, okay? But I could have sat in front of a file drawer, asked questions to Kathy Toy, if she's the expert, and gotten my answers. Yet someone would decide to do this. Well, after I realized that I can't walk into the library and look at the half a dozen things I wanted, well, then you might as well give me everything so I could sit at home and review everything. Every time I want something, I got to do this. And no one in the past that has asked to view records was ever treated like this and given all these copies.
No one in the past has ever asked for these records.
I asked to come in. I came in here the day before Thanksgiving, met two employees who were both extremely rude to me. I had a half a dozen items I wanted to see. I said, what happened to the administrative staff? They said, oh, everyone's gone today. I said, but I checked my email. It didn't say the administrative offices were closed today. And this woman says to me, well, you're off today. Where do you work? You got the day off. I was floored. Who did she think she was talking to? But that's besides the point. I think this was just to show me that how dare I ask for information and I had to jump through these hoops. Susan, if that's how you want to manage your staff, it's your call. But I'm entitled to view information, and I would probably review more information than most people here would. And I would make recommendations. But if this is how you want me to share information, it's your call. And so all of you now have a packet of paper.
Well, the problem here is that all board members are entitled to see the same material.
Good, so now you got it.
Well, yeah, I don't know that we all would have wanted the staff to spend this much time and energy doing this. But the problem is, you know, I don't think the library can let each individual board member come in and go through the files.
Make copies. All fine with me. Whatever you decide.
Well,
the point is I'm entitled to see information.
Hold on. We let you talk. Now it's Karen's turn. Thank you.
I don't think the library can really let each board member come in and start pawing through the files and looking at whatever they want. They can make copies and, in fact, should share the same information with all the board members.
Sure.
But when you ask for massive amounts of information, I think really the board as a whole should decide whether we want this number of copies made and whether this amount of time should be spent gathering all this information together. So I just in the same way, we don't want individual board members calling up the attorney asking for things to be done just as individuals, because that racks up time.
Let
me finish. It does. It racks up time and money. But you know, when you ask the staff to gather all these documents for you and
I didn't.
And,
please.
And, well, I think they do need to make copies for you. It sounded like that's what you wanted. And
no,
besides, in order to share it with everyone else, they need to make copies. But that does consume a lot of time and energy. Just like asking the attorney to do something, it might not result in a separate bill to us, but it does eat up staff time, which is a cost too. So it's, you know, just before large requests are made, I think the whole board needs to decide if we want to have the staff spend that time and energy gathering that all together. Now, I'm not saying short questions shouldn't be asked.
That's just it. What's a short question? I'm looking for details.
5 minutes we had talked about before.
Right.
That was what we had talked about at a table. 5 minutes.
We did. Not
for what? 5 minutes that they would take their time to answer your question. 5 minutes.
You can't. If I wanted to know,
that is what we had decided as a board.
We did have that.
Okay. We had that discussion. We had that discussion.
Well, it made sense.
No, it doesn't make sense. If you want to review something.
We did have the discussion.
We did. And it wasn't.
But
it
doesn't make it right.
Is that in here?
Well, then that
let's bring that up at the next meeting.
But you're not making sense. You're saying, I said you can only talk for 5 minutes. If I wanted to sit here and have a conversation with Tim about technology, and we're going to just put the egg timer on and it's going to end, what if we wanted to review things?
No, that's gathering materials for some question or quest that you have.
Well,
that should be brought to the table.
If you think there's no purpose to this.
That should be brought to the table, discussed here, and we as a board then will decide if that is what we collectively would want that information. You would have to come here, state your case, be transparent, not send something individual if it's going to be more than a 5 minute answer. That is what we had decided collectively before.
I don't recall a collective conversation about requesting information.
Well, that's why I think we should bring it up again at the next board meeting and go around and figure out what our policy will be, and we'll make it a policy.
Well, here's my concern. None of you, or most of you, could care less about anything in these papers.
Actually,
and you don't really review things.
But
I said most of you.
Tim is our treasurer. You're acting as our treasurer, which you were. Tim is now our treasurer with.
So I should have asked him?
I think it would warrant the discussion.
He's our treasurer.
No one said, when I was treasurer, no one asked me that they wanted to see stuff. They just went into your offices and looked at whatever they wanted to look at.
Nobody got in staff files. Yeah. That is absolutely unacceptable. That would never be allowed.
Well, I know they went into the office and viewed information.
They got the information in the blue box. That's
okay.
The month's information. And
it's factually incorrect.
After the check register comes out.
So what you're saying is after 30 days, I'm not entitled to review information.
Well, as I said in my email, you really have got about a week of time to see the things gathered in the box, and then things go into files, and then that policy kicks in. It's your policy. It's not my policy. If you want to change it, change it.
Well, I'm just shocked it's the first time it's ever been enforced.
Nobody's asked for things before. And by the way, this is like maybe a third to a half of the information you've requested. There's still a great deal more to come.
However you want to handle it. And it would have been easier to discuss this with someone, and since you're that person,
so
then you don't have to make all these copies for 7 people.
So then
you could have
right
made
now,
that suggestion to me instead of told me that you were going to make all these copies and make them for all the board. Maybe that would have been a suggestion that would have been beneficial. And I would have
But Tim still couldn't be going in the drawers either. I mean, it still would have involved staff time. You're asking for materials that are kept in different offices, different filing cabinets, different staff working with them. It was a very, very time-consuming request.
I'm sure it was, and that's what I told you when I disagreed with it. But it's your decision.
Time-consuming task to even find me.
Right. Probably is. That's why it would have been easier just to view it.
But I think we're saying we don't want board members viewing historical.
I guess if that's the way it is, then that's the way it is. I mean, because we're all criminals now, and why should we want to try to help move this library in the future? I know, but listen to what you're saying, okay? It's fine. Whatever your rules are, that's fine. And you make whatever copies you have to make, and, you know, and I certainly won't want to go in there and look at any
records. Well, I think what we're trying to say is that as a board member, we come up to the board and we present what information we're looking for and maybe discuss to see if there's a better way to get it or let's discuss it before we go in to that sort of the request.
It's all past information that we've had a chance to look at prior, and there have been no questions. We've been audited since.
But see, here's the part you don't understand. I'm not trying to catch you on something. I'm asking for 6 months of information to be able to make a determination and a suggestion about something we are doing and something else I would like to suggest. I'm not here to catch anybody. It's not a gotcha game, which is what you guys think.
I said it was a gotcha game.
Well, you said this
night,
this
is taking, no, I'm saying
you
that
said
it's 20 hours of our staff work that
if, like
we
I said,
cannot
it's
have
your
one
problem.
Board member ask for and inquire without the other board members' input, and I think this is a policy that we need to look at as a whole
fine.
And create and address.
Whatever you want. That's fine.
And according to, you know, Library Journal, and that is not something that should be done by board members. This is not just us. It's not our table.
Board
this
members shouldn't request information?
Individual board members, no. They should not.
It's right in your bylaws.
At the same time, board members, board meetings are the appropriate place for members to raise questions and make requests, and it's exactly what you had said last month, Jeanette. And so that was just happened to be, it fit right in. And rather than bringing up issues up to staff members or library administration on an individual basis, it should not be done. So we'll have to look at that. Exactly.
You better rewrite this whole thing. Here's another thing I wanted to bring up, and I was going to play it, but.
Oh, let's see. Okay.
Let's lay it on the table.
It's 11:00 already.
Yeah, it's okay.
Apparently.
And this is what we have to do then. Go ahead.
Okay, what, I guess I was just, I was pretty mad when, because I know prior times I could send Linda, Susan, Diane, please add to the agenda. Susan writes me back, I have to ask Linda. Excuse me? Linda?
I was never able to add anything to the agenda last 2 years.
Oh, well, thank you for allowing me.
Nothing.
I never.
Ever.
Well, I never, all right.
Okay, well, so I just letting you know.
Well, I sent my email to them and they put it on, so they're yelling at them and Linda White, so.
Yeah.
So undoubtedly, they didn't like you.
I know.
There was Morgan. Morgan was the board president. He had complete control of the agenda.
But I never went to him. I would email you guys. I'll send you the email. I don't delete anything. I'll send it to you when I request it.
That's fine, but then when Morgan would get the draft agenda, he would be like, take this off, take this off. That's how it worked for 2 years.
So, all right, well, maybe you're going to start out.
Let's see, yeah.
All right, so now I thought, I'm a trustee. Really? That's why I was going to stand on public comments. I thought, I'm a trustee. The president of the board shall preside at all meetings of the board and may vote on motions before the board for action. He or she shall sign documents on behalf of the board as may require signature, shall appoint committees as required to carry out duties, authorize calls for special meetings, which I know you don't like because I have an email, and generally perform the duties of a presiding officer. So in English, all you do is run the meeting. You have no more authority than the rest of us. And when the election came around, the taxpayers voted for 7, not 1. 7. So, I mean, I guess
I'm sorry, just, taxpayers voted for 7 what?
Trustees.
Mm-hmm.
Not 1.
Right. We're just one vote, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you have no more power than I have.
Well, it doesn't create the agenda yet. You do.
Then you better change the policy.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's
responsibility that.
Oh. But when they give definitions, that's not in there. According to this, all she does, you can't deny me as another trustee to put something on the agenda. So,
right.
So maybe we need to revisit the policy.
We better revisit this whole book.
That's fine.
Let's do it.
It is in there.
It's a prepared tax.
What's in there?
Right.
The director.
The board
and the
president should work with the library director to plan out exactly what would be covered, including any items required owing to previous board action as well as.
You're reading from that. I'll go on Google and get same. I'm talking Niles Public Library policy.
It's in there, Jenna.
Where?
It's in the bylaws that the board president and the director create the agenda. It's also in.
I got the bylaws too, but the bylaws and the policy have to coincide, don't
they? Sure, they do. Absolutely, they do.
Well,
and if you're finding something different, then we should change it.
Okay,
change
that's right.
I absolutely agree with you, Bob.
No, I agree. I look here. The library director shall prepare an agenda. Blah blah. I didn't see anything. I do see here the library director shall prepare.
I wish we had brought that up 2 years ago.
What?
Get a library president doesn't have anything to do with the agenda.
I never had a problem.
No,
I emailed
I'm just
them.
Well,
but see, you didn't have a problem. Other people did.
I'm a trustee. I don't have any answer. Anybody denies me, there's a problem here. I have,
well,
you know, don't. Well,
so why were those?
Well, you're not my boss.
Then why were those bylaws okay a year ago, 2 years ago?
Because actually, we never brought them up until now the bylaws come up because we were going to make changes.
They weren't enforced.
They were never.
No.
never saw them before, never, I guess, had a problem, and now that we're making changes, that's when I asked Susan, can I get our policy manual?
So maybe that's something that we really need to go through together.
Oh, we gotta have a special meeting for that.
Well, it looks like it might be more than one meeting, to be honest with you, because it's a pretty thick thing.
It better be a special meeting.
Well, I had planned, once we got all of the initial wave of changes made, to give the administrative policies to Colleen Thorpe to review to make sure that they were completely up to date, and the personnel policies to the Management Association to make sure that all of the HR pieces of it were up to date. So there, yes, there are some changes that definitely will be coming with the policy manual. And I definitely want board input if you want other changes. So anything you want discussed, you know, let us know and we'll put it on.
Really?
So I don't get tonight, I'm trustee too, just like the rest of you.
Because really, I mean technically, and that's how we would be, I'm your boss.
I get that.
Okay.
Yeah, well, I felt the same way, I'm just letting you know.
You should have said something, I know, I'm saying, but I didn't call Morgan, I want this on the agenda. I went, Diane, can you add this? Linda, can you add this? I never went to Morgan, he's not my boss. You're not my boss. You're not my boss.
Well, you just wish you'd given that speech to Morgan, that's all.
What?
I can't tell you because I wasn't here then.
He might have stricken your eyes.
Well, anyway, that's past still.
I didn't know she told him and took him off the agenda. And if he would have taken off the agenda, I would have stood right there and did public comments. So he didn't scare me at all. So moved.
Second.
Okay. Aye. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you, everyone.